A sloppy game today. A lot of rain here in the central part of Pennsylvania. What do you see as the keys to today's contest?
Well, as you said to the coach in the interview, the both teams have to play with the same field conditions. And there, you don't have to worry about a muddy field. You are going to have some pockets here and there, maybe of pockets of pooling water. But most of those are going to be on the sideline. This field drains very, very well, so it shouldn't be much of an issue there. One concern was earlier in the day, the wind. The wind was expected to be a little bit, picking up a little bit more than it is now. Fortunately for Bucknell in the passing game, that's not the case. And I was looking at the AccuWeather radar coming in, not looking like it's going to let up anytime soon as well. Now that bodes a problem, and many people would say, well, in that case, you got to run the ball. That's true, but this is a team that likes to run option as well. So, you know, the first key of this game, the official keeping a football dry. Simple as that. He's going to have the toughest job is trying to keep that football dry so that you can do some of the things you want to do. And I can guarantee you there's going to be one coach that is going to be looking at whoever's going to handle the football on the Bucknell sidelines to make sure a fresh one is in almost every first down to try and keep that ball dry as possible. You know, you look at this game and Colgate averages 6 yards in offensive play. That's amazing. But they're also giving up 6 yards in opponent offenses. So there's a wash there. You think, okay, well, maybe it's because they haven't converted in the red zone. They've done that about 90% of the time, so that's not the case. Well, all right, maybe they're winning the game in the turnover battle. Maybe that's where it's happening. Well, they're plus two. Bucknell's minus one. The question is, how is this Colgate team winning? Well, they're doing it by scoring a lot of points in the second half. So that means Bucknell has to take advantage of Colgate's slow start. They don't give up a lot. They don't score a lot of points in the first half. Only 33 points in the first quarter alone. They give up 50. Bucknell needs to take advantage of that. Know where Pat Simmons is at all times. Here's a guy that they're going to go to in the passing game. Averages about 100 yards a game. Has 3 touchdowns. He's kind of the go-to guy in this offense. Anybody that averages 100 yards receiving the ball per game, you need to know where he is. And it's a no-brainer. If Jordan Scott plays, control him. You're not going to stop him. It's not possible. Everybody's tried. You just hope to contain him. And the other thing for the offense is don't be afraid to throw the ball with either quarterback. Rain, okay, yeah, that's an issue, but the wind isn't an issue. Get Trigg in the ball game, give him a chance to throw the ball. Also, get Lair in the ball game to throw the ball too. Last week, we really didn't see him throw the ball, and a lot of teams are going to look at film and say, okay, when the big guy comes in, know it's going to be the option play. Know it's going to be this play. Now's an opportunity to break that stereotype in a hurry and find Pastrnak. Find Pastrnak, because right now, no team has really double-covered him all year long. And when it does, That'll be an opportunity to change it, and if that's the case, then you can go and find somebody to step up on the other side of the ball. Right now, Pastrnak has been the go-to guy in the air. Need to take advantage of it, even though it's raining today.
And even though it is raining here today, Kevin, I tell you what, we're going to be pleased to see, even in these kind of murky conditions, although thankfully Bucknell, one of the first in fact, in the Patriot League and one of the first in the FCS division to get field turf back in 2001, we're going to see some of the best individual players in the Patriot League. You mentioned Pat Simmons, the 6'6 receiver. He is outstanding. Had a top 10 individual for him and for Colgate. 196 yards receiving last week against arch rival Cornell. Bucknell has its own in Sean Pastrnak, who up to a couple of games ago when he had been injured, he ended up with about 100 yards per game in terms of receptions. In terms of rushers, you mentioned Jordan Scott. If he's healthy, Nate Eaches, who was the rookie of the week in the Patriot League, even if Jordan can't go, yeah, he's a great running back with 240 yards out of the Hazleton area. A couple of Bucknell players actually played with him last year. And then you, of course, have A.J. Kizikai, who's just waiting for a breakout game for Bucknell.
Yeah, he's the type of guy that can make an exciting play on just a simple dive. You know, you get him into the second tier, running into the safeties and the corners, and that's where he is so, so dangerous. You know, one thing I did mentioned, and you did in the pregame with Coach Landis, is the Sinkum effect is what I'm going to call it tonight. We're going to see if there's going to be an effect. They played without him before. It's nothing new, unfortunately, but boy, I'll tell you what, he has been such a big part of this defense early in the year. Look for somebody to say, hey, I got to be the guy to fill the shoes. Or maybe it's going to be two guys to say, listen, we're going to have to be the guys that fill the shoes. And it's obviously it's going to probably be somebody in the middle of the linebacking core that's probably going to have to do that. And they're going to have to do it against one of the premier running backs in the country.
Those are HERS hits. Kevin Herr is our color analyst for today. We're going to take a timeout. When we come back, we're going to be presenting the Geisinger Orthopedics and Sports Medicine Injury Report. That and more comes your way in just a few moments. This is Buck Football on Eagle 107. Yes, I'll try not to forget like I did last time. Good catch. Welcome back to the Geisinger Orthopedics and Sports Medicine pregame show. Time right now for the injury report, sponsored by Geisinger Orthopedics and Sports Medicine. They specialize in treating everything from sprains to the most complex injuries. To find out more, phone them at 1-866-414-4988. Well, unfortunately, still a bunch of people out for the season, and that list grew some after the Georgetown victory last Saturday. Mike Alwyn is out for the season with a shoulder. Also out is Ryan Boyer with a shoulder, Rashad Bumpers with a knee, Al Cabreos with a hip, Tyler McFarlane with a foot. Also listed as out here this year for the Bison, Sam Nana Sinkum, and we mentioned him, what a huge loss for the Bison with that ankle injury. Also listed as out for the year with a foot injury is Jason Volmar. Listed as probable for this game with a knee, Tyler Anderson. Bucknell will need him with an ankle, Nolan Applegate, and with a back, backup kicker and punter Andrew Bell. Also listed as probable is backup running back Brandon Bessant. And also listed as probable today is Jamal Briggs with an elbow. Continuing the probable list with a shoulder, Ian Dalbello. Going to need him, obviously. He's one of the starting offensive linemen for the Bison. Sandy Prasad with a leg is listed as probable, along with Todd Ronaldo with an ankle. Ryan Smith with a foot. Marcelo Trigg with an ankle as well. All of those are listed as probable. One person who is out for this game, not for the season, is Julius Hobson with a concussion. That's a big loss as well for the Orange and Blue with the loss of Sam Nana Sinkum. By the way, just to give you an update here, some of the other teams that are in action here in Patriot League play, Lafayette is hosting Fordham. That's a 1 o'clock game in Easton. Holy Cross is hosting Lehigh. That's a 1 o'clock game there in Worcester, Massachusetts. Georgetown plays out of league here today as they go down to Richmond, Virginia to take on the Spiders. 3 o'clock kickoff for that one. Here today, it's Bucknell and Colgate. That will do it for today's pregame show. Stay tuned. When we return, it'll be the starting lineups and the opening kick between the Bison and the Gate right here on Eagle 107. Hey, Blair, after this set of breaks, you can play a station ID if you want before the game open. Anybody got the love to beat up fast? Gonna come a lot of grass like an eat.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to Christy Mathewson Memorial Stadium for this afternoon's Patriot League football game between the visiting Colgate Raiders.
From Christy Mathewson Memorial Stadium in Lewisburg and the Bucknell University campus, it's time for NCAA Championship Subdivision football action. For the remainder of our national anthem, let's go down to the field, the Bison Chips. The Bison Chips for today's national anthem, that well-renowned a cappella choral group here. And today, the Bucknell Bison bring the old grads back to campus for homecoming 2008 as the orange and blue welcome longtime rival Colgate to Christy Mathewson Memorial Stadium. Colgate leads the overall series between these two teams 40-16, but Bucknell has won two of the last five. Colgate coach Dick Biddle and him with his team, he has just been able to collect his 100th career victory. He says the reason he has won so many games is because of the great offensive lines that Colgate has. He says there are a few reasons why those in the past and this year's offensive line is so good. Well, I certainly appreciate both Pat Simons as well as his head coach, Dick Biddle, the veteran. In fact, he is the oldest tenured coach in Patriot League competition. As we said, he just won his 100th career game. Well, The Bucknell team going to be coming onto the field a little later today, as will Colgate, because it's homecoming and because of all the festivities along campus here today and because of the inclement weather as well. The kickoff time has been pushed back to 10 after. This game also on Bison Vision All Access for you folks who may be listening throughout this great country of ours or anywhere in this world. If you'd like to watch it, just go to BucknellBison.com and you can click on the audio-video link, and the video link will have a picture for you right now, actually, of one of the light standards at Christy Mathewson Memorial Stadium. You'll see some of the rain that is falling. In fact, with our shot, it almost looks like it's nighttime out there. Believe me, it's a little brighter than that, but it still is going to be a very gloomy day today.
Well, and you know, it's a little bit chilly too. It's not cold, it's just damp and chilly, and you can see the steam coming off. And of course, there's puddles along the side here. Fortunately, that's near the track where the drainage isn't quite as good. So the field conditions actually right now look pretty darn good. And as I said in the pregame, this field drains very, very well, except for right along the track. So the only time they're going to have to really worry about that are some of the guys when they go practicing their kicking. As a matter of fact, Orr is probably going to be kicking into a puddle here in the next few minutes where the net is.
Let's go over the starting lineup first for the visitors from Hamilton, New York, the Colgate Raiders. They come in riding a four-game winning streak, and the Colgate Raiders have certainly had a very fine year here this season, as Colgate 1-0 in the Patriot League, and after those four straight wins, 5-2 overall. They'll start this way at one wide receiver, the aforementioned 6'6", 226 junior Pat Simons out of Sydney, New York. He has 43 catches, one of the tops in the Patriot League. 11-catch, 152-yard performance versus Princeton. That was a career high in terms of receptions. He had a career high yardage figure, 196 last week against Cornell. Averages 17 yards per catch. He has three touchdowns this year. Along the line, this is a veteran unit that we heard Coach Biddle talk about. 6'4", 313 senior Steve Jonas out of Webster, New York. First team All-Patriot League, honorable mention All-American last year. Then it'll be Zach Posey, a Boca Raton, Florida junior, 6'2", 282. He's in the left guard slot, starting seven of the first eight games a couple of years ago, also nine starts last year. The center, Justin Snyder, out of Fairfax, Virginia, former defensive lineman, started one game last year, 6'3", 286 senior. Rich Rosabella is going to be a 6'2", 275 senior right guard from Naples, Florida, former fullback, actually, started 11 games in 06 and 9 last year in 07. Then Nick Hennessy, one of the best in the Patriot League, maybe the best offensive lineman, the right tackle, 6'6", 300 senior from Danvers, Massachusetts, second team preseason All-America, second team All-Patriot League last year. The tight end will be Nick Kvetic. He is a 6'5", 243 sophomore out of Clifton, New Jersey. No catches this year. He was actually born in Belgrade, Serbia. He had one start last season. He's more of a blocking back. They do like to go to their backup tight end, Adrian Schrieffer, when it comes down to the red zone. 6'2", 232 junior out of Plainsboro, New Jersey. He has three catches, all for touchdowns this year, and all of those add up to 24 yards, so an on average about an 8-yard reception for Schrieffer. The other wideout will be 6'1", 173 junior Ty Henry from Orlando, Florida. He has one grab this year for 9 yards. His backup, though, Sam Breslin from Wayland, Massachusetts, 5'11 senior, has six catches, 108 yards, no TDs, one for one passing as well, 67 yards and a touchdown earlier this year. And Doug Rosnick is the second leading receiver for this Colgate team, 6'2", 220 sophomore from Langhorne, PA, 11 catches, 115 yards. Quarterback came in for the injured Alex Ralph early in the season, and Greg Sullivan has performed magnificently. 6'1", 204 sophomore from Monroe, New York, has completed 61% of his passes, does have three interceptions to his credit, but over 1,000 yards, 1020 to be precise. He has four touchdowns passing, four rushing, as he's carried the ball 100 times for 568 yards net. 5.6 yards every time he rushes the ball. That's just another threat that Colgate has. Fullback, mostly a blocking back, 6'2", 243 senior from University Heights, Ohio, Eric Tupta, but he does have eight receptions this year, averaging 8 yards per reception. No TDs, only career TD, actually, versus Bucknell a couple of years ago. And Jordan Scott may get the start. If he does, he's the Hyattsville, Maryland junior, 5'11", 205, has a 5.7 rush per carry average, 11 touchdowns this year. He's a Walter Payton list finalist, probably will be, 30 yards from four 1,000-yard seasons. That's amazing. All four of his seasons have had 1,000 yards at least, and he'll have another one this year, I'm sure. All-time FCS carries leader. He does get a lot of carries. His 270 yards versus Bucknell, the second highest number in Colgate history as well. If he doesn't start, Nate Eaches, the freshman from Drums, PA, and Hazleton Area High School, 5'10", 195, will get the start. He only carried the ball 241 yards. Let's go down to our referee, Greg Camara, with today's coin toss.
Okay. Heads and fall. And it's a tail. It's a football. You've won the toss, Captain.
Let's defer to second half.
Defer to second half. Okay. Bucknell has won the toss and defers their choice to the second half. Oh, which goal do you want to defend?
Defend the scoreboard.
Defend that goal.
It's wet down here, Doug.
Ryan Unger is the third member of our group today. You just heard him with Greg Camara, the official referee today. And, of course, Bucknell deferred. They have decided to kick the ball off, and Colgate will move right to left. Bucknell left to right. Bucknell in the tradition orange jerseys. That was a tradition that Coach Tom Gadd started in his first year in 1995. And he, of course, passed away in 2002 because of a brain tumor. But let's go down to Ryan Unger because the field conditions are not the great. Well, the field conditions are bad, but the weather's not the greatest, Ryan.
Well, it's easy for Kevin to say it's not too chilly as he sits in the press box. But it is a little chill in the air, but the team seems to be ready for it. The field a little bit slick. You have to remember that it's a thin turf. It's not the thicker field turf, so there might be some opportunity for slipping down here.
And we see you right now on Bison Vision All Access, Ryan, as he gives a wave, a salute to all the folks watching.
Nice beard, by the way.
He is a bearded one right now. Our officials are set for this contest. Colgate will be in the road white with the silver football britches, as our former compadre, Georgia, longtime Georgia announcer Larry Munson would say, with his dogs. They have the maroon helmets with the gate on either side. Bucknell in the orange jerseys, as you can see on our Bison Vision All Access. Again, a tradition started by the late Tom Gadd here in his first year on homecoming each year. Blue helmets with the secondary mark on either side. Bucknell will boot this one right to left. Colgate will receive this one left to right as they will sprint back there to the left side. Noah Jackson and Kenny McKenzie. Should be to the right side. They may have switched some things up here. We'll double check on that. They will switch some things up, and instead we're going to see Charles Babb, who is a backup wide receiver, on to receive this kick by Will Carney, as Bucknell will kick it towards the north end of Christy Mathewson Memorial Stadium. The ball is set. Carney is ready, and ladies and gentlemen, it's game time on the Bison Sports Network. Here comes McKenzie. Jackson, rather, up the middle, cuts it outside, breaks free of a tackle at the Colgate 30, and he'll be pushed forward to the Colgate 34, and very good field position for the Colgate Raiders as we start this contest and they move left to right.
And that was very dangerous, Doug. There was no outside contain, and when he broke about the 30-yard line, he only had one guy that could stop him, and fortunately that's the one who made the tackle, but I see a Bucknell player down at about the 35-yard line.
Going to have to wait and see who that is.
I thought it was number 10 is what I thought happened to glance at.
Well, that would be a backup quarterback, and it may be Brandon Bessant, but maybe they actually put David Noche on the kick coverage team. He is a backup quarterback, and they're looking at his right leg down around his ankle. You see Mark Kepler with his back to you on Bison Vision All Access. So the kickoff return that time was by Noah Jackson. And McKenzie wasn't out there. Instead, it was Charles Babin. They tend to, I'm guessing it's probably, well, we'll have to wait and see once they raise him up. I'm surprised it'd be Noche. No, I was thinking it was Brendan Bessant.
Oh, it's 40, yeah.
Yeah, Brendan Bessant, the freshman out of Canada. And he is being tended to right now. And then you can see at least on Bison Vision All Access, they are keeping him elevated on his right leg. And, boy, that looks very similar to what happened to Sam Nanasinkum last week at Georgetown. They are not putting any pressure at all on that right foot or ankle. Greg Sullivan will be the starting quarterback, and it will be Nate Eaches, the Hazleton area product out of Drums, PA, the freshman who rushed for 241 yards on 37 carries last week against the Cornell Big Red. Sullivan will have three wideouts to the wide or right side. Sullivan in the shotgun. Here comes a quick pass out to Simons' right side. Good blocking. He comes up the near sideline to the 40 and is wrestled down at the Colgate 42, about a couple of yards short of a first down. Strong safety Rob Gerlach brings him down, but a quick screen, a pass on first down, that's something Colgate doesn't normally do.
Yeah, and you know, the receiver did a great job of making a block that bought him about an extra 5 yards. Bucknell had coverage there, but nice job by the wide receiver there on doing something that most wide receivers take for granted, a block.
Simons has his 44th grab of the year. Now Tupta will come in the backfield along with the shotgun quarterback Sullivan. Eaches off to his left. Here's the handoff to Eaches. He'll try right side. Now he'll break it outside, have a first down as he drags would-be tacklers. That's Noah Jackson, who got the grab going left to right, and he was able to take it for a first and 10 up to the 49-yard line. Free safety Akeel White brings him down, but first down of the game for the Raiders.
You know, if there's one drawback for the young running back there, it's he's got quick feet, but he's always looking for a hole instead of running for what's there. And I think that's what caused it to be a little shorter than what it should have been.
Four wideouts for Colgate. No score first period. First offensive drive. First and 10 Colgate at the Colgate 49. Out of the shotgun, Sullivan. Todd Rinaldo jumps but didn't touch anyone, so he gets back after going into the backfield for the Raiders. First and 10, Colgate. Here's the shotgun snap. Now it'll be Eaches getting the fake, and here comes the quarterback off right side, Sullivan. He'll take it for about 3 yards before Brigham Farron, who gets the start at safety today, knocks him down at the 46 of Bucknell. It'll be a pickup of 5.
You know, I'm surprised the center, the defender jumped, could see him clearly. I'm surprised the center just didn't snap the ball. I mean, he could have gotten a free 5 yards on it, but he just kind of held out.
Got 5 yards anyway, but it did cost him a down. It's second down and 5. Two wideouts to the left. Tight end, actually fullback Tupta on the line of scrimmage off to the left side, just about a hair back. Out of the shotgun, Sullivan takes the snap. He'll go with the inside handoff fake, and then he'll take it around left side, and he'll pick up a first down as he'll clamber inside the Bison 40 down the left side of the field to the 35 for being brought down by looked like Nisley on the stop. Another first down for the Raiders, and that's one thing we heard from the Raiders staff, including Bob Cornell. Sullivan, a very good ball faker.
Well, and that's what I was just going to say. That was one of the best fakes that you'll see. I mean, he put the ball right in the breadbasket, took it right out. You know, I always talk about how well Trigg does that. This kid does it just about as well.
And he is a kid. He's only a sophomore. Greg Sullivan out of Monroe, New York.
Everybody's a kid to me, Doug.
Me too. First and 10 at the Bison 35 for Colgate. Here comes the inside handoff. No, it'll be Sullivan keeping it. He breaks a tackle, fights inside the 30, down to the Bison 29. Faked the handoff to Babb, coming right to left, then followed his right tackle, the big Hennessy, off right side, inside the Bison 35 on first and 10. He'll gain 6, down to the Bison 29, second and 4.
Linebacker Craig Jones read that like he knew what was going on. He was in the backfield, had Sullivan by the legs, and somehow Sullivan got out of it. Just want to set up a little bit and give him a shot there instead of just going for the legs and wrap and just reaching.
Second and 4 out of the shotgun with Eaches off to his right, Sullivan, 2 wideouts left. Second and 4, as we said, no score first quarter. Here comes the inside handoff to Eaches. He'll cut it out to the left. He'll get stood up as he'll gain to the line of scrimmage down to the Bison 28. And not pick up much more. De La Rosa was in on that stop for Bucknell. And also coming off the bottom of the pile, it's going to be Greg Jones, the aforementioned linebacker from Virginia. It'll be a 3rd and 3 now for this Colgate team with 12 minutes left first quarter.
This will be your first 3rd down test for this Bison defense. This is a must stop here if they want to get the ball back and take advantage of a slow starting Colgate team.
Colgate averaging about 48% on 3rd down tries. 3rd and 3 out of the shotgun. Sullivan gets the inside handoff, and it'll go to a twisting, turning Eaches, and he's going to be stopped very close to a 1st down, maybe just a shy of about a foot or so at the Bison 25. He went right to left, Eaches did, off the handoff from Sullivan, and Rinaldo brings him down to be 4th and 1, and it looks like Colgate may go for it at the Bison 25.5.
Yeah, they had to get to the 25-yard line, and that ball is going to be about a half a ball width from the 25. It's a good call, but I'm surprised they're doing it out of the shotgun.
Sullivan will be the quarterback in the shotgun. Each is off to his left. Power is to the left. 2 wideouts to the right on 4th and 1 at the Bison 25. Inside handoff. Each is gets tied up, and I don't know that he got it. Boy, they're giving him a great spot. Bucknell stood him up behind the 25, but they're giving him a push all the way to the Bucknell 24. De La Rosa made the stop on Eaches. That's going to be a 1st down, but I'll tell you what, I kind of thought Eaches' forward progress was stopped behind the 25.
Yeah, the whistle didn't blow as early as I think Bucknell fans wanted to see. He ended up spinning off and then going off the left side and getting a couple of extra yards on that.
And it's going to be 1st and 10, Colgate. No score, 10:45 and counting left to play here in this first period. Sullivan out of the shotgun. We'll have Eaches off to his left. 2 wideouts right, 2 to the left. Bucknell ball at the Bucknell 24. Sullivan takes the snap. He'll go back and draw a play. He'll cut it off to the right side, get hit by Jones, and then about a bevy of orange-shirted bison will drop him after a pickup of one up the middle to the Bucknell 23. It'll be second down and nine.
I want to go back to that fourth down play as well. This is why you don't want to run a shotgun and then run the shotgun draw out of that or hand it off. He's got about 4 yards to go before he gets to the line of scrimmage. Just sneak that, and you don't have that situation. They got out of it that time, but fourth and one again, I'd be willing to shoot some linebackers in there if they're going to go shotgun.
Second and eight, really a long eight, short nine. Each is off to the left of the shotgun quarterback. Sullivan will get the play action to him. Now Sullivan rolls out to his left, fires deep down the right sideline, and a good job by Simons to turn inside as the ball was to his inside shoulder on the far side pylon. Akeel White, the free safety, had gathered on the 6'6 Simons, who had come to the far side pylon on the near of the end zone, and then he had to turn right on the pass that was inside, and he adjusted but couldn't come up with it. It'll be third and eight.
Teams have been picking on the secondary all year. They have not been turning around. That is a textbook defensive play.
Great job by White, the youngster of free safety. Third and eight now for Colgate with three wide outs right. Eaches comes into the backfield to block. Here's a quick pass, and it's going to be short hopped at the Bucknell 10, intended for Babb. Good coverage in front of him by Jamal Briggs, who gets the start ahead of Brandon Simmons and also Todd Manjuck back there. So it'll be fourth down. And let's see, it looks like Jacob Stein will come on. He, in terms of field goals this year, is 7 of 9, a long 35. This is going to be a 40-yard kick into a very heavy rain. Ball in the middle of the field. The holder for him will be Ryan Myers. So a 40-yard kick, kicking it left to right.
This is going to be like hitting a stone.
Going to be tough. Let's see if they go for a fake. Line of scrimmage at the Bucknell 23. High snap. Stein puts his right foot into it, and it goes to the Gold Coast to our right. And it is good. Longest career field goal for Jacob Stein, and the senior gets Colgate on top after a 10-play drive. We're going to take a timeout. When we come back, we'll talk to Ryan Unger in a moment. 9:39 left first half. Colgate draws first blood as the Raiders will lead this 3-0 after a 10-play drive. This is Bucknell football on Eagle 107. Hey, hopefully, Blair, you started the CD. Great job. Hey, just to remind you, Ryan, remember to look at the camera when you talk. Ten plays, 43 yards, and a career-long 40-yard field goal by Jacob Stein gives the Colgate Raiders a 3-0 lead. Stein with the right foot gets a pretty nice boot that will send Kizikai back to the far sideline to his 7. Up the far sideline to the 20, breaks free to the 30, breaks free to the 40, spins past a man at the 50. He will have it all the way to the Colgate 40-yard line. There's A.J. Kizikai, who ran back a kick for a touchdown last year, and he was dragged down, saving a touchdown by Nate Eaches. And let's go down to the field and Ryan Unger.
Yeah, Brandon Bassan taken into the locker room, taken off for further evaluation. Doesn't like we'll see him back. The defensive coaching staff telling their guys they're in the right position. They just need to wrap up and make tackles next time around.
And I thought the Bison did a better job after that initial couple of plays in wrapping up. Bucknell will have it officially at the 41 of Colgate. And let's see who will start quarterback. It's going to be Marcelo Trigg, the Tampa junior who has completed 72% of his passes. 10th on the Bucknell passing charts now. Three 200-yard games, 18 yards from 2007 career high total. He'll have backs to his left and to his right. Marcelo starts out at the 41 with a play action. He'll roll, he'll fire. It's going to be complete to Pasternak. He'll break free down the near sideline. Gets a block at the 30, down to the 20. He gets belted out of bounds at the 15. Somebody misplayed the defense for Colgate. And Pasternak, the Clark Summit Youngster grabs it and takes it down the near sideline inside the 20 to the 17 of Colgate.
Two things happened on that play. One, Pasternak made a spin move that just left Colgate just trying to figure out which way he was going. And Odenbach came in and made a downfield block that just opened up a huge hole to run through.
Now the shotgun at the 17 of Colgate. Bucknell first and 10. Marcelo Trigg gets the play from Harold Nichols, the offensive coordinator, with 12 on the play clock. Mullen in at fullback. Hizekai is off to his right as a tailback. Two wideouts to the right side. Now a man in motion. There comes Pasternak to the left side. Inside handoff to the fullback. Here is Mullen. He'll break it free to the 5, to the 2, to the 1. And guess what? For the first time this year, it is touchdown! Your Bucknell Bison, Kevin Mullen, one of the game captains today. And there was a huge chasm in the middle, 6-3 Bucknell.
Boy, I'll tell you, when Pasternak went in motion, everybody went with him. You talk about respecting. That was a beautifully designed series of plays by the offensive coordinator and the offensive staff. Great job.
Well, the Colgate defense has struggled most of the year. Did a good job last week against Cornell. Inside snap, kicked by freshman Drew Worth. It is good. Great job by Andrew Lehrer to hold on an inside snap from his brother Alex. And Bucknell now has jumped on top, 7-3. 8:46 left here in this first quarter, and we'll take a timeout. This is Bucknell football on Eagle 107. Two plays, 41 yards, and a 17-yard touchdown run by Kevin Mullen, his first touchdown of his senior season. And it's 7-3 Bucknell, just about a minute after the field goal, the career long by Stein that put Colgate on top, 3-0. 8:46 left to play here in this first quarter. Carney kicking it right to left as it will hang up there forever. Jackson for Colgate. Hobson grabs it at his 15, up the middle, to the 20, to the 30, to the Colgate 40, and he'll have it all the way up to the 45-yard line. They'll stop him at the 46-yard line. The guy at the bottom down there for the Bison was Akeel White, who will stay on his free safety. And, boy, both of these kickoff return units are doing a good job, or the kickoff teams are not doing a very good job, Kevin.
Well, I think it's a little of both because, again, Bucknell had contained because they ran to the middle of the field. That time it was just they weren't able to get through a great blocking job by the wedge blockers from Colgate. The kickoff before that, it was no contain on the outside and almost cost them a touchdown.
Sullivan comes out with the Eaches off to his right, so we have not seen Jordan Scott at all. Two wideouts to the left. Tight end, right, actually fullback Tupta on the right side. Inside handoff to Eaches. He will break free for a couple of yards behind his center Snyder up to the 47, maybe the 48. I think they'll give him forward progress to the 49. Eaches is stopped, though, as coming at the bottom of that pile was Todd Manjuck, as Manjuck will grab for him his 40th tackle of the year, and it'll be second and 8 for Colgate. Good shot at Todd on our Bison Vision All Access.
Yeah, you know, what I like about this defense is they don't – some defenses have some sort of a huddle. These guys all look for the signals from the coach. Even the linemen are looking for a signal. I love that.
Second and 7, they'll say out of the shotgun. Sullivan, each is to his left. It'll be a play action pass to Simons. Low grab, good blocking, comes down the far sideline. He has a lot of room. Down the sideline to the Bison, 30, and then gets tripped up on an ankle grab to the 25. Similar play result as to what happened – when Pasternak broke one on a long pass, misplayed by Bucknell. The defense got sucked up. Casey Williams saved a touchdown at the Bison 23, first and 10 Raiders.
You know, the wide receiver, Doug Rosnick, was the one that made that play happen. Again, like we talked about with Odenbach, made a great block, had no chance, actually pancaked the guy a little bit and had no chance of making the play.
Each is off to the right now of the shotgun quarterback, Sullivan, first and 10 at the 23 of Bucknell. Here comes the handoff to Each, spins away from a man, and he's gone to the 10 and down to the 9-yard line. Bucknell grabbing and not sticking the running backs or quarterbacks. Touchdown-saving grab by Bucknell's Bryce Roberts, and another first down for Colgate. They'll have it inside the 10 at the Bucknell 9.
I guarantee you when this linebacking core and this defense comes off, Coach Cohen is going to say, guys, I want to see you guys hit somebody. We're reaching, we're grabbing. Of course, he'll do it a little more colorfully than I will. But
first and goal for Colgate at the Bucknell 9. Now the shotgun, Sullivan gets the snap. He'll go with the handoff. Big hole for Eaches down to the 5-2-1 touchdown as Eaches had three against Cornell last week, and he'll get his first today, and now Cornell has jumped on top 9-7.
But again, everybody reaching. Nobody squaring up and trying to make the hit.
Four plays, great field position to start this two for Colgate, and they are able to go some 54 yards in four plays, and of course that 9-yard run by Eaches and the freshman from Hazleton area puts Colgate on top 10-7 if Stein can hit the extra point. He had a 40-yard field goal a moment ago, so got to figure he's going to. Well, the snap wasn't that great, but it took so long, and there was such good blocking by those big hosses up front. Myers took forever, had a sandwich, put the ball down, and Stein puts the ball through, and it's 10-7 Colgate, and let's go down to the field and Ryan Unger.
Yeah, Kevin mentioned that they weren't wrapping up and tackling. That's something the coaches were emphasizing on the sideline, to square up, wrap up, and drive them to the ground. And unfortunately, it didn't happen that time for the Bison.
And Bucknell had actually done a better job, as you just got a good view of Ryan Unger a moment ago. Bucknell had done a much better job of doing that, stopping Colgate and forcing them to a 40-yard field goal opportunity and a make by Stein last offensive series. This time, though, it appeared Bucknell got a little bit more wet out there, just couldn't hold on to anybody.
You know, I don't know what they put on the Colgate uniforms are coming out of the locker room, but it must be something with silicone, because they just cannot get anybody down right now. And these running backs, credit the running backs, they're making some nice spin moves, but boy, as a defender, you sit there and you see a running back spin, you want to get the opportunity to hit him right square in the back. He won't spin anymore.
Each just has six carries, 31 yards, and his fourth career touchdown run. Meanwhile, Bucknell, Trigg, one for 24 yards, and of course the 17-yard run by Kevin Mullen. Here's Stein with the right foot. He'll boot this one left to right, deep to receive. Now Kizikai on the near side as opposed to the far side, and it looks like Stein is looking to try and hit it to the far side to Applegate. And they will. They'll pop it up short. It's going to be taken by Mullen at his 22 to the 30. Breaks free of a tackle at the 33, and then is going to be dropped at the 34. Not as good a field position for Bucknell, as Brad Keeley brings down Kevin Mullen, and it's 10-7 Colgate here with 7:04 left in this first period.
Well, the Bucknell special team wins the battle of who's going to make the first special teams play. That wasn't a huge play, but considering the way these two teams have returned the ball on kickoffs, that was a big one.
Now let's see who comes out at quarterback. Bucknell waiting for the last second to bring a quarterback out. Now it's going to be Andrew Lehrer. Now the defensive coaches make some substitutions as another linebacker comes in for Colgate. So let's see what happens as Andrew Lehrer, senior from Metairie, Louisiana, had a 58-yard touchdown run against Georgetown last week. Gets it out of the shotgun. Goes option left. There's a big hole down the near sideline for Kizikai. He breaks it to the 40, to the 50. Kizikai to the 35, to the 30, to the 20, to the 10. He's grabbed up high. Should be a pace mask, I thought. But it's a touchdown-saving tackle on Kizikai as he raced it down the near sideline and grabbed up high. Out of bounds by Chris Epco at the 8-yard line. Let's go down to Ryan Unger.
Safety Brigham, defensive back Brigham Farron getting worked on. They're trying to get him back into the game, working on that right knee that's been bugging him.
Well, now it's a long run by Kizikai from his own 34 down to the 8, and Josh Lee will come in for AJ. What a great run by AJ.
You know, you wonder how that big of a hole can happen. They had man-to-man coverage on the two receivers over here. They brought in the extra linebacker looking for the play. Still nobody was there. Bucknell took advantage of it and took advantage of it big.
Now Marcelo Tringa, quarterback at the 8. And in motion, Lee, left to right. Here comes the snap to Trigo. Go with a pass, man, wide open. It's a touchdown guy, Alex Lair! Touchdown, your Bucknell Bison! A great fake up the middle to the running back, Josh Lee. There comes Trigg, pulling it back, throwing it to a wide open touchdown grabber, tight end, Alex Lair. His second touchdown of the year. First was against Robert Morris. He is getting hugs from his teammate, as you can see on Bison Vision All Access.
But his brother walks out, walks right beside him, says, I got a job to do. I'll congratulate you later. I'm going to hold.
Indeed. Andrew Lair will be the holder. Bucknell only took two plays to regain the lead. Good snap this time. Orth's kick to the goalpost to our left, and it is good. With 6:28 left in the first quarter, it's 14-10 Bucknell. Not a whole lot of defense out here right now, Kevin.
No, well, you know, we talked about how Colgate gives up 6 yards a play. Well, right now it's about 60 yards a play the way this offense is moving.
Let's go back down to the field, and our sideline reporter, Ryan Unger.
Offensive coordinator Harry Nichols told his team, we're going to have to score a lot of points here. They wanted to make some adjustments. They felt they were overplaying Pasternak, and you saw in that last play.
Boy, I tell you what, they are really paying a lot of attention to Sean, and rightly so. But they consider him as Bucknell's big threat. Well, he's not the only one. Josh Lee could do what A.J. Kizikai just did. Kevin Mullen can certainly give you a 15, 20-yard run anytime as well.
Well, we talked about the way this passing attack has been working with Pasternak and how nobody's really paid that much attention to him over the first five games or so of the season. Well, now Colgate is. We talked about somebody having to step up. I'll tell you what, Lair was wide open in the back of the end zone. I think I could have thrown it there and hit him in this weather.
Well, in fact, Trigg actually let him a little short, and Lair did a great job at 6 feet, 3 inches, tight end, go down low and scoop that up and hold on in this rainy weather here at Christy Mathewson Memorial Stadium for Trigg. That's his eighth touchdown pass completed this year, and Trigg already was 1 for 1. He's 2 for 2 and a touchdown here.
I don't know if Coach Nichols had this game scripted out or not, but offensively it's going exactly the way he would have drawn it up, I'm sure.
Would just like to have some turnovers and get the ball back to score more points without letting Colgate get the ball. See what Bucknell does this time, because Jackson's hurt the Bison on kickoffs. 14-10 Bucknell, 6:28 left in the first quarter. Here's Carney to boot it for the Bison. Jackson off to his left, to our left, and Babb to the right. Carney will hit this toward the sideline, and it will be taken at the sideline by the running back, Jackson. He bobbles the ball and fumbles it out of bounds at the Colgate 25 after he was hit by Applegate. Nolan, good job there. Still battling an ankle injury, and it'll be first and 10 Colgate. Good view here on Bison Vision All Access of Noah Jackson. Got the ball knocked out of his grasp at the 25. Were you surprised he picked it up? It looked like it was going to go out of bounds.
Well, it's one of those in-betweens. It's like, okay, this ball has now rolled about 20 yards, and it's been fairly straight. I know I'm close to the out-of-bounds, but I don't want to take any chances. I think that was a good safe play.
Sullivan, the quarterback. I think it's Eachus off to his right in the shotgun. It is, and it'll be a play action himself down the middle. Here's great defense, and it's intercepted at midfield by White, and Akil has it at the Colgate 45. They were going to go deep to the wide receiver at midfield, Doug Rosnick, the second leading receiver for the Raiders. He got hung up on the inside coverage, and that left the free safety, Akil White, with an interception, his second of this contest, or this year. Picking it off at midfield and running up to the 45. There's a good shot of Akil, and hopefully Akil is okay, but that's a big mistake by Sullivan. For him, that is going to be his fourth interception of this year.
Well, Doug, that was a weather-related pass. It slipped right out of his hands. You could see it kind of wobble and just hang in the air, and Bucknell got a chance to take advantage.
At the 45, Trigg, the quarterback, hands off up the middle. Here's Kizikai getting hit as he'll spin off right guard inside the 40, down to the Colgate 44. He was hit hard, but spun away from that initial hit and then was brought down by Mira for the Raiders. It's going to be second and about 4 for Bucknell, leading 14-10, under 6 minutes left, first period. That was the turnover Bucknell needed.
Unfortunately, though, the offense is under their per-play average of 26 on that play. I exaggerated a little earlier. It's 60, but not by much.
Good view of Marcelo Trigg on our Bison Vision All Access as Bucknell breaks the huddle. Second down and 4 at the Colgate 39. Ball in the middle of the field. I formation with the fullback in a three-point stance, Kevin Mullen. Tailback is going to be, it looks like, Josh Lee. It'll be the option left pitch. Here comes a little run by Pograno, and he'll have it off left tackle inside the Colgate 35. He'll be close to a Raider first down at the 34-yard line, being helped to the turf by Mike Carbone. But it is first and 10. Bison, their fourth first down of this game, leading by four. And I'll tell you what, Carbone, a very good linebacker for the Raiders, as that is his 42nd tackle of the year. But Colgate has normally had veteran linebackers, and they are missing them this year.
Well, you can see some of the inexperience here early in this game, but I thought that option play they handled well. They had hat on hat there.
First and 10. Now Larian at quarterback. He'll go option right. Pitch it late. It's not a good pitch, but a great diving grab by Pograno. He'll lose yards. Line of scrimmage, the Colgate 34. He'll grab it on the far hash mark at the 40, so it's going to be a second down and long. And that's the only bad thing about switching quarterbacks, Kevin. Sometimes, in this case, Lair, a little bit off on the miss time.
Well, and again, that was another weather-related one, because it looked like as he made the pitch, he didn't quite have the grasp of the ball that he normally would. And, you know, I don't know if Bucknell's able to change the ball fairly often or not, but it may be time.
Now it's second and 16. Bucknell, Lair back on. Ball at the Colgate 40. Two wide outs to the left side. Lair with a blitz on, gets hit as he throws. It's off the hands of Pasternak, a little high on the near sideline. He would have had it back to the original line of scrimmage at the 34. At the last second, a safety came in there and blitzed, put pressure on Trigg. It'll be third and 16.
Running back did a nice job of picking it up, but he picked it up a little too close to Trigg, and Trigg wasn't able to step forward on the pass play, so that ball ended up going a little high.
In terms of Trigg, he is 2 of 2, now 2 of 3 for 32 yards. Bucknell, 3rd and 16. Trigg brings the play in from the sideline. Bison lead this 14-10 with 4:19 left first period. Bucknell got an interception at midfield. Needs to put some points on. Could be a blitz upcoming. Here comes a pump fake down the near sideline. Trigg is hit as he'll throw it. And he was trying to go to a wide open Pasternak down the near sideline, but he got hit as he released it. Looked like Carlton Walker, who leads this team for Colgate, with a bunch of sacks, three coming in, hit him as he released. It'll be fourth down and 16, and Bucknell will look to punt. And that's a shame, because Bucknell had great field position to start this at the 45. But that bad pitch by Lair really hurt Bucknell.
Well, now's an opportunity for Phil to go ahead and pin him deep. This is something he's struggled with this year.
Pat Simons, with his heels at the 10, will come on to get this punt, and it's going to go into the end zone. Yep, bounced at the 4 and goes on a hop into the end zone. So Bucknell will net no yardage on this, and Colgate will get it. And they dodged a bullet there. The defense came up big for the Raiders, just as Bucknell's did last time.
Well, again, Colgate really learned how to handle the option a little bit better in that series than I thought they did in previous series. Even though Bucknell was able to get about 5 yards and a first down on that one option, you could see that the flow of the defense was going toward the football, where last few option plays, the flow of the defense was everywhere but.
At the 20, first and 10, Colgate moving left to right, trailing by 4. Eachus will go to the left of the shotgun quarterback, Sullivan, with 4 wideouts, no tight ends. Sullivan gets the snap. He'll go with the inside handoff to Eachus. Big hole up the middle to the 20, up to the 28. To the 30-yard line of Colgate. It'll be a first and 10 for the Raiders. Their 6th of this particular first quarter. And today's game is brought to you in part by M&T Bank. They understand what's important. With M&T Choice Equity, you can lock in a fixed-rate loan within your line of credit, so your rate and loan payments stay the same. How's that for peace of mind? M&T Bank. First and 10, Colgate at the Raiders 30. Again, Sullivan out of the shotgun. Have 2 wideouts to the right. Fullback tupped on the line of scrimmage to the left. He'll be the option to the left side. Sullivan gets hit as he'll pick up a yard or two to the 32. He faked it nicely, but Bucknell's Brigham Farron wasn't fooled too much, nor was Marcus Morgan, the defensive end on the far sideline. It'll bring up a 2nd and 8 for Colgate.
Yeah, I like the defensive alignment there a little bit better than the last time. Bucknell had about 5 guys on the line. They brought up the middle linebacker, shifted one of the outside linebackers over just a little bit. That gave them an extra defender in the middle of the field to try and avoid that handoff right up the middle they'd be getting burnt with.
Simon, single wide receiver right side. It'll be a handoff to the left side. Big hole down the far sideline. Looks like Braff's going to save a touchdown. Handoff went to the backup tailback that time, Jordan McCord, the freshman from Chicago, Illinois, who coming into this contest for the Raiders as he takes it up to the Colgate 48 on a first and 10 play. McCord had carried the ball 23 times, 101 net yards, 4.4 yards each time he touches it. And now it's first and 10 Raiders at their own 48.
Starting to see how Colgate has the record they have. Their offense moves the ball very fluently, but their defense only steps up a couple of plays, it seems.
First and 10, out of the shotgun, Sullivan goes with the inside handoff. Eaches. He runs hard at midfield and then gets stacked up by Ronaldo and a host of other Bucknell Bison. They'll drop him at the 49-yard line. And they're giving him all the way to the 48. I thought his forward progress was stopped at the 49, but they'll give him an extra yard at the 48 of Bucknell. Pick up a 3 second and 7.
It's getting a little foggy.
It is getting a little foggy. May not be easy for the officials to see. A lot of rain here in central PA, and it's going to rain probably for the course of this game. Second and 7, out of the shotgun, Sullivan with two wide outs to his right, tight end to his left. That's Kapitka. Here comes the inside handoff. Eaches breaks free, spins, then Jones will hold on and drop him after a 2-3 yard cup to the Bucknell 46-yard line. Nisley in on that stop as well. Sixth play of the drive upcoming for the Raiders, and it'll be a 3rd and 3 for Colgate, trailing 14-10, under 2 minutes left first period.
This is where Colgate likes to go to the edges a little bit and run the run almost quarterback choice, if you were a veer. Let the quarterback make the read.
Out of the shotgun, it's the quarterback Sullivan with three wide outs to the right. Long count. Nobody was drawn offsides by Bucknell. So now Eaches will line up to the quarterback Sullivan's right. Here comes the snap inside run, and the ball is fumbled, and it's picked back up by Sullivan. It was right in the breadbasket of Jones at the 45. He had clear sailing, but he lost the ball back into the quarterback for Colgate Sullivan. He takes it off the bobble and picks up a first down Colgate at the Bucknell 37.
Well, that's exactly what it was. It was Sullivan on the read, either give it to the back or take it himself. He went, and as he pulled it out, the ball just went straight forward, right literally into the hands of Greg Jones, who's going to see that film, and he's going to want to try and crawl under the chair.
At the Bucknell 37, Sullivan out at quarterback with two wide outs right, Tupka the fullback at the right side of the line. It'll be the inside handoff. He just gets some blocks and he'll run over a man inside the Bucknell 35. He'll be stopped at the 33.5-yard line. Pickup of three is Farron and Nisley helped to bring down the very bruising running back Eaches. Of course, if you just tuned in, Jordan Scott, after the ankle injury early against Cornell, did not get the start today, and Eaches has gone the distance to this point.
He had a great lead blocker in front of him, Steve Jonas, who is a senior at 6'4", 313. I mean, you talk about plowing the field. He was doing it.
Second down and 7. He and Hennessy are definitely pro prospects for Colgate. Out of the shotgun, Sullivan goes with a quick pass to Simons. 6'6 player gets a lot of blocking down the far sideline. He'll have a first down and more inside the Bucknell 25. He'll be wrestled out of bounds at the Bison 21-yard line. He faked it inside, and everybody went inside. And again, Bucknell having very bad tackling angles, just like Colgate's defense has been. Two pretty young defenses out there for both of these teams, and it'll be first and 10, Colgate trailing by 4 at the Bucknell 20.
Again, Rosnick making a great block as the receiver on the outside on the cornerback gave him no opportunity to make the play. Matter of fact, they took that block about 5 yards on the sidelines as well when they were fighting there.
At the Bucknell 20, first and 10 Raiders, each is off to the left of the shotgun quarterback Sullivan, and the play clock runs down, and I don't know if it was reset. So they may actually ask for a reset of the play clock because I don't think that Colgate, with 4 ticks left on the first quarter, took that much time, and I think they're going to wind the clock down to end this first period, and Colgate will not get a snap off. Well, a high-scoring first quarter here in Lewisburg on a drencher of a day. It is Bucknell 14, Colgate 10, but the Raiders have it when we resume play in the second quarter as they'll move right to left now at the Bucknell 20. Kevin Nye and Ryan as well will be back in a moment. This is Bucknell Football on Eagle 107.
We'll receive a pizza and drinks sponsored by Domino's Pizza. They are also enjoying their upgraded seating sponsored by Silver Moon Furniture. Fans, be sure to purchase the game program at the next home football game, and you too could win. Name of the game, courtesy of Silver Moon Furniture and Domino's Pizza.
Yeah, I got you, Blair. Thanks. Welcome back once again to Christy Mathewson Memorial Stadium. Start of the second period. Colgate trailing 14-10. We'll have it at the 20. A good Bison Vision All Access of defensive coach Pat Kingman. And you see on his left sleeve there a band that the coaches are wearing for muscular dystrophy here in this game. Here's a handoff to the right side, and he just runs over a man. So he'll take it inside the 20. Ran over Ronaldo, tried to grab him around the legs, and he just high-stepped his way out as he ran off behind his right tackle, Nick Hennessy, and takes it inside the 20 down to the 18, second down and 8. Hard run for Eaches, who on that gained a couple of yards, and he averages about 5.1 yards per rush, and now he's going to go out of the game.
Yeah, that's what I was just going to say, Doug, because Eaches took a big-time hit, and he looked kind of woozy. They may want to check to see if he knows what state he's in.
Well, now coming in will be the freshman McCord. A little smaller than Eaches, taller but smaller build-wise. Second and 8 out of the shotgun at the Bucknell 18. Colgate Sullivan, he'll take the snap. He'll go with the handoff to McCord, breaks it free up the middle, and he'll score. Touchdown, Colgate. 18-yard run by McCord, and for McCord, he will get his third touchdown of the year. And that was too easy, just as Bucknell's Kevin Mullen scored easily for Bucknell. The problem is Bucknell got a turnover on the interception, couldn't do anything with it. Now, most likely, Stein will hit this extra point. It'll be 17-14 Colgate.
And things have shifted. They, you know, they had one drive. Right now, that's the only drive that Colgate hasn't been stopped, or that hasn't scored, rather, was the interception. Unfortunately, Bucknell couldn't take advantage. And again, big holes right up the middle on those plays.
Again, snap a little bit behind Myers, but Stein, the veteran, will kick it through the uprights. Good. And 14-11 shows on this first half clock, and it is 17-14 in favor of Colgate. Hey, Service First Federal Credit Union and Bucknell are teaming up for a special promotion. Stop by their Lewisburg branch and register to win a weekly gift certificate from Damon's Grill. You'll then be eligible for the grand prize, a chance to be on the air with the Bison Sports Network for an upcoming Bucknell home football game. Check out all the details at the Service First Lewisburg branch across from Damon's Grill. 17-14, as you see on our Bison Vision All Access, and the Bucknell defense huddling up, and Bucknell needing to try and make some stops here on the touchdown run by McCord. You have first quarter stats, Kevin.
Indeed I do. First downs, Colgate has 9 to Bucknell's 4. They've rushed the ball 18 times for 108 yards, netted 49 in the air as Sullivan goes 3 for 6 with an interception. Bucknell with 5 carries for 80 yards on the ground, 32 of them in the air as Trigg goes 2 for 4 without an interception. That's 112 yards offense for the Bison, 157 for Colgate. Leading the way, Nate Eaches on the ground, 10 carries, 51 yards, and a touchdown. A.J. Kizikai on the ground, 2 carries, 64 yards, and his longest, a 58-yarder. Sean Pasternak with a big reception, 24 yards. The touchdown, it was a reception by Alex Lair for 8 yards. Simmons, as I said, has caught the ball 3 times, all 3, as a matter of fact, for 49.
14-11 left, and this kickoff going to Applegate at the Bucknell's 17. Up the near hash mark, gets a nice block by Kizikai, breaks it free to the 40, and he'll race all the way up to the near hash mark to the Bucknell 40-yard line, being dragged down at that point by Mike Carbone. The linebacker will stay out there, I do believe, for Coach Dick Biddle's team. You know, this Colgate team have won 57 of their last 74 Patriot League games, 23 of their last 36, though, decided by 9 points or less. They're used to close games.
Doug, we talked about in the pregame here that this field has some pockets in it where it doesn't quite drain as well as others. Right now, Bucknell is sitting on one of those pockets at about the 35-yard line. Running the option could be a challenge here as that water seems to pond right about there on the hash marks.
First and 10, Bucknell wide side to the left with 2 wideouts there. Shotgun quarterback Trigg will have Kizikai line up to his right. Mullen to his left. 4 down linemen for the Colgate Raiders. Inside handoff to the fullback Mullen, and he'll take it past the Bucknell 40 to the 41 before being hit head up by Greg Hadley. Hadley out of Fayetteville, New York, junior with his 43rd tackle of the year. It's 2nd and 8 for Bucknell.
Not a whole lot of running room there, but there's a lot of beef on that Colgate front line. Those guys, what are they averaging, 280 at this point?
Actually, a little lighter than that, about 265.
I think that might be a little bit generous. Those guys are big there, 280. That might be the official weight, if you know what I mean.
Second down and 8 out of the shotgun. Trigg gets the snap. He'll look for a pass to the near flats, caught by Polgrano, who had a grab for 6 yards against Georgetown last week. He'll take it on a little down and out to the near sideline before being grabbed up high again by Chris Epko. Epko has to watch that. He's very close to getting an illegal grab up there that high in the back of the helmet. It's third and a long one or a short two for Bucknell.
If his hand slips off, it becomes a horse collar in a hurry with a high tackle. But in his defense, that's the only way he could have made that play, because doing a great job, you keep your head down. And I thought that time that Belgrano did a great job of doing that and leaning forward.
I formation behind Lair, the quarterback. Third and two. Lair taking time, goes with the option right. He will keep it around right side, and he will get stood up and dropped at the 49. It'll be a fourth and one. Let's see what Bucknell does here as Colgate comes up with the defensive stop by Julius Barley. And Lair a little shaken up there as he faked it inside to Mullen, then took it around right side. And now with Bucknell trailing 17-14, they may go for it, because Bucknell's defense has not shown any ability to stop Colgate except when Colgate stopped itself.
And Bucknell has been able up until that last play to get 3 or 4 yards of play. They only have to get to the midfield stripe. And I think the only drawback with the last play was they ran it into the boundary. They were trying to catch Colgate looking for all the flow to go to the wide side of the field and take advantage of it. Unfortunately, Colgate's defense did exactly what they should. They stayed at home.
Bucknell has 120 net yards as the Bison will take a timeout to talk about this fourth and one near midfield. Colgate 177, 128 of those on the ground. And Colgate, when they rush for a hold the opposition to 100 yards or less on the ground, they are nearly unbeatable, like 56-6 over the last 12 years under the Dick Biddle era. Net yards rushing for Bucknell, 83. A lot of that, though, on that one run by Kizikai. He hadn't touched the ball a whole lot since then, though.
You know, what I like in this huddle right now on the near sidelines, first off, both quarterbacks are in this huddle, so Colgate really doesn't know who's going to come out of this huddle. But what I also like is Coach Nichols sitting there, and Trigg's doing all the talking. It's not Coach Nichols that's doing the talking. It's Trigg that's doing the talking. He said, okay, and what I'm assuming he's talking about is, what play do you feel confident in that we can get this 2 or 3 yards that we need, or 2 yards that we need?
Now, in terms of individual player stats, as you can see, it's still raining. Sullivan, 3 for 6, 49 in a pick here, long of 28. Eaches has 53 yards on 11 carries. And Bucknell breaks the huddle, and let's see. Andrew Lair will be the quarterback on this critical fourth and one at the 49. They'll come up to the line of scrimmage with an I formation behind him.
Oh, run the sneak. It's there.
It is. There's a big hole, but now Lair will get the change of play with 6 on the play clock. Here comes option, midline option, and Lair will go off right guard and pick up a first down. Anthony Carter able to sit down his defender there. Barley, who ended up making the tackle, but first and 10 Bison at the 48, and you're right, you saw it up here.
Oh.
It was open.
Colgate was not in any sort of goal line or short yardage situation, and a great checkoff from the sideline. He had the left side of the center open, he had the right side of the center open, either way he wanted to go.
Good shot of Andrews, kind of limping some with that ankle that he had hurt against Hofstra when he had, at that time, a career-high 78 yards rushing. First and 10, Bucknell. Trigg, now the quarterback. He'll send Lee in motion, right slot to the left. It'll be option, pitch to Lee, and he bobbles the ball, picks it up off the hop. He has some room down the far sideline to the 40. Stutter steps past a man, and it's dropped out of bounds at the 35. I think that hop almost looked like Australian rules football. He picked it up off the hop just as Sullivan had a huge play off a fumble and picked it up off a hop, picked up a first down. I think the defense froze when they saw the ball out there free for anybody. Hop back to Lee, and he took it up to the 36, they'll say, first and 10 Bucknell.
You know, I thought that was a little early pitch from Trigg that time. I thought he could have held it a little bit longer, but I believe it was A.J. Kizikai on the lead block that actually made that play happen. That could have been a disaster 5-yard loss.
Well, remember Lee, or Kizikai blocked for Lee against Georgetown last week. First and 10 Bucknell at the 36. Blitz is on. Inside handoff against it. Here's Smith cracking free, and Ryan, the fullback, will take it from the 36 of Colgate on first and 10 to the 30, and it'll be dropped by Barley, who's way down the field for a defensive lineman. Pickup of 6, 2nd and 4. It's 17-14 Colgate, 11 minutes left first half. Bucknell on the drive again.
Colgate's defense is, to use a cliche, on their heels by far right now. They have no idea if it's going outside, inside, over their heads, if it's going to bounce off the turf. They have no clue right now defensively what's coming up.
New defensive coordinator Coach Zabo was the defensive coach for the linebackers for Michigan under Lloyd Carr. 2nd and 4, option right, and it stood up and dropped. No gain for the fullback Mullen that time as Trigg took it off right guard and handed it off to Smith. He got knocked down to the turf here by Jim Mira, the Montgomery, Massachusetts senior, at 14 tackles coming in, but tied 4 tackles for loss last year.
And I think that was just a bad read by Trigg that time. He looking to make the decision on which way he wanted to go with it. I think that was a bad read. As he came over to the sidelines, he kind of looked like he was defending his call there.
Now Lair stays on the sideline, kind of nursing that ankle, and Trigg stays out there for a third and four with four wideouts. Now Kizik in the backfield for the shotgun quarterback, Trigg. Here's a blitz up the middle. Trigg rolls out to his left on a bad wheel, and he's going to be sacked at the 38. He should have looked downfield because Cadman was open down at about the 10, but he was rolling to the left. Cadman was to the right. Now what will Bucknell do? It'll be a fourth down and 12 at the Colgate 38, and will Bucknell go for it here, trailing 17-14 with Bucknell not doing anything defensively, and badly enough, Phil Azra can't seem to pin anybody deep.
Well, that's what I was just going to say. You punt it, you take a chance on going into the end zone and bringing it out to the 20. You go for it. Well, it could be the 38-yard line or worse. Too long for a field goal. If you try and draw them off sides, it's not going to be enough for a first down. It's almost worth just taking the delay of game and bringing out the punting unit then.
Bucknell this year on fourth down conversion, 6 of 9, and Bucknell with 3 on the play clock will have to burn a timeout. 9:13 left in the half, 17-14 Colgate, our last commercial of the break of the half. We'll take it. This is Bucknell football on Eagle 107.
Soccer action at home stadium on Tuesday night with the Bison host NJIT. That's at 7 p.m. Tuesday evening.
Well, Phil Azrick is going to come on and punt this one away now, and now Colgate going to have to rush their punt return unit on. 9:13 left. Bucknell burned its second time out of the half to decide on a 4th and 12 at the Colgate 38. They would instead punt this one away. Second straight punt for the Bucknell O. And Colgate can't seem to be stopped by the Bucknell D. See if Azrick can somehow get somebody pinned deep. Well, this one's going to be caught by a fair catch by Simons. I don't know if that was a great move. Of course, both of these teams bad in terms of punt returns. Bucknell averages 3 yards a punt. Colgate 2 yards a punt, and with his heels at his 10, he backed up, Simons did, and caught it at his 9. I don't think it would. I think it would have gone in the end zone. I don't think anybody was down there for Bucknell, but Colgate went 80 yards last time, and now they'll go 90 for a touchdown.
That was a tough decision. There was some outside contain from Bucknell that might have gotten there. With it being a heavy, wet field right now, it could have stuck. Now, if this was a grass surface, they would have probably plugged.
Yes, stayed in there. Sullivan has two backs back to him. He'll go option, hand off to the first back through, and that's McCord, and he'll have a pickup to the 15, and that's a pickup of 7 on first down before Brigham Farron can bring him down. 17-14, and the score, Colgate by 3 with 9 minutes and counting left in this first half.
I am amazed when they run that midline running play how far downfield the offensive line is. Jonas that time was 7 yards downfield from the line of scrimmage. That is an enormous surge.
And in 3, short 4, shotgun quarterback Sullivan now has a man in motion. And it'll be the inside handoff fake to him. And here comes Sullivan rolling right, wobbly pass, and a good adjustment. But again, the pass way inside of Tupta, the fullback who lines up as a tight end sometimes, who has 6 grabs coming in. He couldn't hold on. It'll be 3rd and 3 at the Colgate 15 for the Raiders. And boy, Sullivan, who has gotten much better in terms of passing, like 17 of 20 last week against Cornell, few passes we've seen to this point haven't been too pretty.
Yeah, and it is not the ideal night to be throwing the football, but you got to be throwing it a whisker better than that if you're going to drop back.
3rd and 3 could be the quarterback draw by Sullivan, who is waiting with 10 on the play clock. Now Each is back in there. He'll line up to his right. He's okay from that hard hit. He'll get the inside handoff, and no! Did Sullivan keep it? No, Each is dead, and they will stop Each. Good fake by Sullivan. Looked like Nisley. Also Todd Rinaldo trips up the running back that time, Nate Eachus, after a pickup of two, and it'll be fourth and one. Let's go down once again to Ryan Unger.
That was a big stop, guys, down here on this sideline. The defense really wanted to dig down deep, and they were encouraging. Coach Landis came over and even talked to the defense. Not something you see a lot here on the sidelines. Big stop for the Bison.
And here comes, for the first time today, the punter, Jacob Stein. He does them both, and he gets an end-over-end kick. That's going to be taken with a flag down by Bucknell's Pasternak in for Applegate. He breaks a tackle at the 50 and will come across the field to the left side, to the 45. Flag from the field judge. You almost have to think it'd be too many men on the field for somebody. Let's see what happens. Pasternak returning that punt as opposed to Applegate, who had struggled some from punting. Bucknell would have it at the 44 of Colgate.
I'm wondering if that was a hold, because the field judge threw that flag about 30 yards. That has to be a Christy Mathewson record. I don't think I've ever seen a flag go that far from an official.
Now, the big question is, was it after the kick, Ryan? Because if it was before, it'd be a first down for Colgate.
Absolutely. I'm not sure about that. Nothing occurred within the shadow of the lineman, but Nolan Applegate really took a hard hit. He was being talked to by Mark Kepler. They usually go through a list of questions asking. Kevin always asks what state, but they ask a little more deep and delve a little deeper on that. But I think they're just a little questioned if he's still woozy, and I think they're going to be monitoring him throughout the game.
Let's take 10 seconds for station ID. The hold puts the ball back at the Colgate 49. Let's go to station identification. You're listening to Bucknell Football. Doug Birdsong, Kevin Herr, Ryan Unger. Our director today is Terry Burke. Our camera operator is Alan Yee, being soaked on the field. Also, Mark Beltramello and Nico Petrides, much better up here in the booth, a little dry like us. But that hold, which occurred at the 45, maybe that's why the official threw it so far, at the 45, excuse me, takes the ball back to the Bucknell 41. So good field position is wiped off here. 7:41 left in the half. Bucknell trailing 17-14 to Colgate. And here's Trigg. Back to pass. Heavy pressure. Throws a wobbly one over the middle. And it short hops to Pasternak at the Colgate 45. He was pretty well covered. And it'll be second and 10. And Trigg really having trouble now getting a hold of the ball in this wet surface.
Well, he's wearing that, I don't know, some call it a muffler. You know, he puts his hands inside of it to keep him dry. You know, sometimes they have a little towel in there to keep it dry as well. I saw him just go back to that a few seconds ago after that pass play.
You just saw from our director, Terry Burke, a graphic. Two-time Offensive Player of the Week, Marcelo Trigg in the Patriot League. He needs a big play here on second and 10. No blitz, but heavy pressure. Trigg, wait, bam, wide open down the near sideline. It's going to be a diving attempt for Polgrano, and he'll drop it at the 38. He had all day, Polgrano did, and he didn't run to the ball. It's like he stopped, and at the last second he dived for it. But maybe that's because he missed so much of the preseason with a knee injury, his first real action last week against Georgetown. But that ball hung up there so long, he should have gotten that grab.
Yeah, he misjudged the angle of that ball completely. He slowed up, and then right at the last second he realized he wasn't going to reach it, tried to put the burners on and stretch out, had it on his fingertips. On a normal day, I think he would have made that catch. Unfortunately, this isn't a normal day.
A lot of rain. 7:31 left before halftime. 17-14 Colgate, and an even bigger third and 10 Bucknell. They've punted the last two times. Free safety blitz upcoming. Trigg pumps. Goes deep. Man, wide open. It's Pasternak. He has it at the 10, at the 5, at the 2, at the 1. Does he fall over? Yes, indeedy he does. What is it? Touchdown! Your Bucknell Bison! Ho-ho-ho-ho! Trigg to Pasternak. Where have we heard that before? 59 yards, the longest reception for TD Pasternak this year. And Bucknell vaults on top 2017. He was wide open.
It was all about the pump fake. The pump fake, and all of a sudden, the defender just stopped dead in his tracks, and he was no chance of not catching that ball.
Here comes Orth for another extra point. Lair to hold, his brother Alex to snap. High snap. Lair puts it down, and the kick is through the uprights by Drew Orth. And Bucknell goes on top, 21-17, a third and 10 play, and a huge grab by Pasternak down the far sideline. 7:21 left in the half, and the Bison now jump on top, 21-17. Longest touchdown pass of the year for Trigg. The longest before was to Pasternak, 57 yards, this 59. to Pastrnak. And Pastrnak has his seventh touchdown receiving this year. And also, Trigg has his ninth touchdown pass of the year. And by the way, today's game is brought to you in part by M&T Bank. They understand what's important. With M&T Web Banking and Web Bill Pay, you can do virtually all your banking online, just the way you like it. And they're fast and incredibly easy to use. That's M&T Bank. Doug Birdsong, Kevin Herr, Ryan Unger. How big was that for the Bison, Kevin?
Oh, man, I'll tell you what. You're talking about an emotional lift for an offense that was kind of getting a little bit flat. There is a lot of bounce now. And, you know, when that was set up by a big stop on the defensive side of the ball, it was it goes back to the punt that was fair caught at the 9-yard line. Bucknell's defense took charge of that series. They made him punt it right back. Bucknell got the ball with great field position in the middle of the field and took advantage of some Colgate inexperience and mistakes.
Even with the hold on the punt return, thankfully it was a hold after the ball had been punted. If it would have been a hold before the ball had left the foot of Stein, it would have been a first down for Colgate, and that would have been huge in favor of the Raiders.
Tragic for the Bucknell Bison.
You got that right. Now here's Drew Orth to kick. We had heard from Ryan Unger that Will Carney was battling a thigh injury, and so Orth will kick off, and it's high but short, taken by Babb at his 15. Up the middle, big hole to the 30, and he's dropped by Robertson at the 38-yard line. Bucknell's kick coverage team really has suffered, and that may have been because Orth kicked that so high but so short, the kick coverage team didn't get a chance to get under it, as Robertson did bring down Babb. Another good kickoff return for Colgate, trailing 21-17. They'll have it at the Raiders 39.
And you're exactly right. That's exactly what happened, Doug. The ball was hit high enough, almost hung there like a punt for a little while, but it was so short that Bucknell's defense couldn't quite, or a kick coverage couldn't quite collapse on the runner.
Inside handoff, big hole for Aegis, breaks a tackle at the 50, and in fights to the Bucknell 49, first and 10. He goes for 12, and he has near 100 yards. We have 7 minutes left, first half, 21-17 Bucknell, but it's so tough to go against 313, 282, 286, 275, 300. That was Snyder in the middle at only 286 opening that hole.
Yeah, he's got to eat a couple more burgers. He's not quite at the line average yet.
At the
These
Bucknell,
guys are huge.
At the Bucknell 49, 6:50 left, first half. First and 10, Colgate out of the shotgun. Sullivan hands off to Aegis. Big hole off left side. Breaks a tackle. He's to the races to the Bucknell 30, and he'll be dragged down at the 29. Again, arm grabbing out there for Bucknell. Of course, playing without Sam Nana Sinkum. A good 20-yard run that time by Aegis, and it's first and 10, Colgate at the Bucknell 29.
You hinted to something I was just about ready to talk to about. Colgate right now has had much success up the middle, running behind Posey and running also behind Jonas, and they have done it where Nana Sinkum normally would be.
At the Bucknell 29, Sullivan the shotgun quarterback with two wide outs right. Aegis back there will get the handoff, and he gets tripped up. It still fights forward for 3 yards down to the 28-yard line. They'll give him one. Thought he got more than that, but they didn't give him as favorable a spot. Morgan and De La Rosa bring him down, but great job by the freshman. He put his right hand out and was able to carry the ball for an extra yard. As we can see on our graphic on Bison Vision All Access, he just had 241 yards rushing. Here at about 3:30, he's going to be featured on CBS College Sports. At CBS College Sports, the old CSTV, at the 28-yard line. Now the shotgun, Sullivan, fourth play of the drive, handoff right, and there's Big Jackson. He'll carry it for a first down and more down the far sideline. Breaks an arm grab by Jones. He'll take it inside the 10 at the 8 as Noah Jackson got that carry. Normally a cornerback, but they're running him at running back because Scott is out. It'll be first and goal at the Bucknell 9.
How many spots do they have for numbers on this scoreboard here, Christy? Because this one's going to be up in the, this one could be in the 80s by the, between these two teams, the total scoring. Wow, are they moving the football all over the field.
Here with 5:23 and counting left, first half, 21-17 Bucknell, but first and goal Colgate at the Bucknell 9. Back split next to the shotgun quarterback, Sullivan. Takes the snap, goes with the option right, gets hit, but still fights for 6 yards. Got hit at the line of scrimmage, spun forward, not even really running, just spinning and falling forward. He falls down to the 5, maybe the 4-yard line before Manchuk can bring him down, and it'll be a second and goal at the 4. Bucknell needs a turnover.
Yeah, and all the pressure right now is on the Bucknell linebacking core. And this is a linebacking core right now that's trying to find its, put itself back together now. And as I said in the pregame, somebody's got to step up and say, I got to fill Sam's spot.
Now, power to the left side as Tupton will move that way along with Kvetic, the tight end. Out of the shotgun, Sullivan, he'll go left. Here comes Eaches getting hit at the four, spins to the three, fights to the two, carries people to the one, and is he over? Probably.
No, I think he's short this time.
Yeah, stopped about the 1 foot line. I mean, he just carried tacklers for Bucknell for 4 yards. He got hit at the line of scrimmage, but take him to the one, and it's going to be now third and goal. Bucknell needs a turnover for a touchdown. If they could get a turnover for a touchdown and get a lead of 28-17, then Colgate would press, and that would not be what they like to do.
Well,
but
and they don't like, and in this kind of weather, throwing the ball is not a strength.
And third and goal at the one, probably the quarterback draw. Here's Sullivan handing off to Eaches, gets hit, spins, and is he over? Fumble the ball. Bucknell says they have it. Bucknell says they have it at the one. We'll see. There's a big battle for it. It's either fourth and goal at the one for Colgate or first and 10 Bucknell. And the way the officials are saying, it's fourth and goal for Colgate at the one. And good hit on Eaches, who spun away again. That was Brandon Simmons who hit him. And Bucknell, I guess, saw Tupta fall on the ball for Colgate. Eighth play of this drive. It'll be fourth and goal for Colgate at the 1 foot mark.
And you know, this is a huge decision for Colgate if they want to go for it here.
Because
points right now are important in this game.
If they don't get it, and you would think they would, because they aren't, they score 90% of the time, most of those touchdowns in the red zone, but if they don't, Bucknell would get the ball, granted, in horrible field position, unless they fumble again and Bucknell runs it for a 100-yard basically fumble return for a 28-17 lead. 3:33 left in the half. 21-17 Bucknell. Fourth and goal, and Colgate will go for it. They still have three timeouts on the board.
Boy, this is a gutsy call in a game where points are everything.
If Bucknell defense can hold here as they did against Georgetown the second half, it would be the defensive stand of the year. And now maybe Colgate's going to talk it over because nine on the play clock and they still haven't broken the huddle yet unless they're going to go with a quick snap. They may take a timeout and try and eat up as much of the first half clock as possible. 3:09 left, two on the play clock, and Coach Biddle will take a timeout. Service First Federal Credit Union and Bucknell are teaming up for a special promotion. Stop by their Lewisburg branch and register to win a weekly gift certificate from Damon's Grill. You'll then be eligible for the grand prize, a chance to be on the air with the Bison Sports Network crew for the November 22nd Bucknell home football game against Fordham. Check out all the details at the Service First Lewisburg branch across from Damon's Grill. Bucknell is averaging 33 points and 383 yards at home, and right now Bucknell kind of on pace for that with 21 points, 3:09 left in the half. And Bucknell had great field position off a pick in the earlier part of the first quarter against the quarterback, Sullivan, by Akil White. Couldn't get any points. That could prove to be huge, and this could be proved to be a huge play here. Fourth and goal for Colgate at the Bucknell 1 foot line.
Well, fourth down and goal. The Bucknell Bison have seen this several times. You know, you go back to week number two against Robert Morris in that huge, huge play that kept Robert Morris out of the end zone, gave him the win. And it's an opportunity right now to really stand up and take control of this game and shift momentum. Right now, momentum is just kind of neutral. Nobody really has it. Whoever's got the ball has the momentum, and Bucknell's defense right now has a chance to spark the orange and blue.
92 yards rushing for Eaches, and we still have 3 minutes left in the half. 49 yards rushing for the quarterback, Sullivan, who's in the shotgun with two backs to his right and an I formation, but off to his right on fourth and goal at the Bucknell one. It'll be the inside handoff to Eaches. He pushes the pile forward for a touchdown, Colgate. So good, hard job by Bucknell. Defense made Colgate work. 3:05, plenty of time for Bucknell to find five or six wide open receivers for a touchdown, or better yet, get a kickoff return for a TD, or no, better yet, get a long drive at the half and score with 3 minutes left. Oddly enough, though, Colgate is 3-0 when they trail at the half. So they are not used to losing games, whether they trail, unless they trail by 40 points. If Bucknell could do that, then I think it'd be tough to be 3-0. Here's Stein for the extra point. Good snap, and the kick is good as well. So 24-21, big fourth down pickup for the Raiders, but good job by Bucknell's defense to make Colgate work. Maybe that makes Colgate think that, hey, maybe this isn't going to be as easy as just running through warm butter.
You know, I am quite impressed with the, and I knew they were big, but the offensive surge that Colgate has. They're running these short yardage plays in the shotgun. And we talked about this in the first quarter. You have a good 4 or 5 yards before you get to the line of scrimmage as a running back or as a quarterback when you're running on in a short yardage play. So, in other words, they're getting 6 yards when they only really need 1 or 2, that you would think that the defense would have a chance then, as they have that 5-yard run up to the hole, to get in there and make the play. But the offensive line is getting such a great surge, is putting a helmet on everybody, including the linebackers, that there's no opportunity to get there in time.
These guys were youthful guys. These 4 seniors out of the starting 5, the only one who's an underclassman, and he's not really, he's a junior, Zach Posey. They were youngsters when Bucknell in a shootout beat Colgate here in 2006 to secure a winning season after a 1-10 2005 campaign. I tell you what, next year, Colgate better have a lot of good linemen standing and waiting. I know we heard Coach Biddle before say, we normally have great line, and they did, except for when these guys were young. And there are going to be a lot of young guys most likely next year, except for Posey.
Boy, I am just, and you mentioned it, these guys are NFL-sized linemen.
Here comes the kickoff to Kizikai at his 8, up the near numbers to the 20. Gets hit and spun down at the 29 of Bucknell. Be a 1st and 10 Bison at their own 29. 2:58 left to play in the half. 24-21 Colgate, and Bucknell, after an 8-play 61-yard drive by the Raiders and the 1-yard run by Eachus, his 2nd touchdown of the game and 5th of the year. He had 3 against Cornell last week. Needs to get some points on the board here, preferably a touchdown.
And again, Bucknell sitting at that 30 to 35-yard line. To our left, on the near hash mark, it's the puddle zone.
It is. There's a puddle right in front of them at the 34. Quarterback is Trigg. Lair has not come back after tweaking his ankle. 1st and 10, Bucknell. Out of the shotgun, Trigg. He has a lot of passing room, and he'll throw a deep out near sideline, and it's dropped by Lee. Had it, but he was looking down to see where the sideline was, and he bobbled it out of bounds at the 48 of Bucknell. It'll be 2nd and 10, and boy, I tell you, Trigg would be almost perfect if a couple of these guys could catch passes.
You know, and I was thinking that as well as I watched Laren in at wide receiver that time. You know what? That set up a play somewhere else down the line. I don't think they just threw that one there and said, all right, let's move him out to wide receiver. There's something else going on, and now they're going to swap spots,
well,
and Trigg is going to be the wide receiver.
Well, you got to feel Chris Epco. He's not going to catch the pass, but you never know. 2nd and 10 at the Bucknell 29. Spread option offense. Bobble, but here's Mullen breaking free as he'll take it off left guard behind Ian Dalbello. Bobbling the ball off the center exchange was Lair, but he was able to hand it off at the last second to Mullen, and he clambered for some 10 yards and a 1st down for Bucknell, their first in a little bit, the 8th of this game for the Bison. No huddle for Bucknell with 2:43 left in the half. It'll be 1st and 10, Bucknell at the Bison 39. Here comes Trigg back to pass. He'll throw one a little wobbly as I think somebody for Colgate got a hand on it on the near side of the field. Incomplete at the 46-yard line intended for Pasternak. I think it was Mancuso who got a hand on it as Lair comes back in at the huddle.
And now Lair will be, as he was the intended receiver that time, looked like he might actually be the quarterback, but I guess Lair's coming, or I guess Trigg's coming back now to take command of the offense and put him back out of wide receiver. I'm telling you, I feel something's coming here.
We'll see. At the 39, 2nd and 10, Bucknell. Clock stilled, 2:35 on the incomplete pass. Pulgrano in motion. Inside handoff to Smith. He breaks free of one tackle, breaks free of another. Then we'll fight off right guard to the Bucknell 46-yard line. Bucknell only has 1 timeout left as they had to burn a couple in inoperable moments. And it'll be a 3rd down and 3 for Bucknell here at their own 46. Tackle made that time by Hadley.
What I think is going to happen is Lair is going to take 3 steps back. They're going to throw it to him and let Lair go downfield to somebody else. Or maybe they'll do it with Trigg. That's what I feel is going to happen in this. It's interesting. It's an interesting offensive formations with him at wideout.
Play clock at 12. 4 wideouts on 3rd and 3, Bucknell. Bucknell band is playing. Here's a long pass. Trigg gets caught by Pasternak, and he'll be brought down at the 47 on the far side of the field by Epco, or possibly it could have been on that far side, Moten, I think it was, at the 47, 1st and 10, Bucknell. And Bucknell band continuing to play while the Bison have the ball. That's not the way it's supposed to be.
This is a surgical drive right now.
1:43 left in the half, 24-21 Colgate, but Bucknell looking to tie it or maybe take the lead at the half. First and 10 inside the 47 of Colgate. Trigg out of the shotgun with four wideouts. Trigg back to pass. He'll throw one over the middle. It's tipped up in the air and dropped down. And again, Mancuso, I think, got a hand on it. So it's second and 10. Stops the clock with 1:25 left. And Trigg had a man open, but he went too low on the trajectory, I guess.
Yeah, not the worst thing that could happen. At least when you bat it up in the air, you get a really nervous feeling. But that ball wasn't batted really high. The lineman didn't even see it. It went so harmlessly to the ground. And it was a quick play that stopped the clock.
Stay tuned. At the half, we'll have our Meet a Bison. Today, we'll speak with Chris Wonkowitz. His brother Jason played here. And Bucknell Alumni Association Board of Directors Admissions Committee member Gary Thaniel will join us as well. But a big second and 10 Bucknell at the Colgate 47. Bucknell will play at Holy Cross next week. Down and out pattern, high, incomplete, intercepted. Bounced off of the chest of Kizakai at the 40, and it's picked off by Colgate. Now with 1:19 left in the half, and the way Bucknell's defense has not been playing at all, except for a couple of drives. Colgate gets a huge play there, and they'll have it at the Raiders 42. I didn't see who picked it off, but whoever did, it was a big pickoff.
Well, it was the guy that was Chris Epco, who was covering to the near side, shifted over to the far side of the field that time, and boy, I'll tell you what, that's just like a thank you very much. Send a Christmas card over to AJ for that one, because it bounced literally right off of AJ's chest protector and right into the hands.
The receivers are dropping too many balls out there. At the 42, Sullivan out of the shotgun, two wideouts left. He'll go with the draw play to Aegis. Huge hole, breaks free of a tackle and gets stopped at the 48 of Colgate with two timeouts left. Colgate can use that play with 1:09 left, but maybe they're just going to run out the clock of the first half.
Well, that's what I was going to say. They have two timeouts left, but this isn't a really quick strike offense. This is a methodical drive offense.
But it can be with Simons out there lining a slot to the left, second and four at the Colgate 48. Sullivan, shotgun quarterback, blitz on. It falls back. Sullivan rolls left, looks for Simons, throws it over the head of Rysnick. He'll catch and run out of bounds because Bryce Robertson gave him about 5 yards cushion at the Bucknell 41. Now with 48 seconds left, Colgate's going to get a field goal, and then maybe that's a good thing. Colgate leading at the half. They're 3-0 when they trail at the half, but they're not nearly as good when they lead at the half. They'll have it at the 41 of Bucknell first and 10.
And if you're the Colgate coaching staff, you're like, how in the world does that happen?
It's weird, but it's usually close, except for the Furman game where Furman pounded Colgate. First and 10 at the 41. Sullivan, the quarterback for the Raiders, two wideouts right. He'll go with the inside draw play, big hole for Aegis. He gets hit by Jones, spins him forward for 5-6 yards. A little late push and shove there by Colgate. At the 37 of Bucknell, no timeout taken with 36 ticks left in the half, and Colgate will line up here in a no huddle at the 37. We'll have Ryan Unger speak with head coach Tim Landis at the break. Second and 7. Colgate, 26 ticks left in the half, leading by 3. Low snap out of the shotgun. Could be a pick here. Long, wobbly pass. It's up for grabs, and it's caught by Simons at 6-6. He'll have it at the 15, and here comes a timeout. Colgate with 17 ticks left. Should have been an interception, but Simons did a great job grabbing it, and it'll be a field goal opportunity at the least, probably a touchdown by Colgate at the best, and it'll be at the Bucknell about 13-yard line here, first and 10 Raiders.
Doug, Bison Mania is later on this afternoon, right?
Yeah.
Because that looked like the opening tip of a basketball game at the Soika. That ball just sat right up in the air. They took the big 6'6 guy, and he went up and out, jumped everybody.
It should have either been picked off or just pass interference. Just run into him, undercut him, and knock him out of the way, and don't let him go up and grab that. But Bucknell has young guys in the backfield defensively, just like Colgate has a lot of youth out there as well. Now they're in Stein's field goal range. But again, even if they lead 27-21 at the half, or even if they lead 31-21 at the half, Bucknell has to feel good because Colgate has run up and down this field in that first half. And the Bison just need a couple of breaks to go their way, and they could win this game, no doubt.
250 yards offense in the first half for Colgate right now.
A lot of yardage. And 24 points here. First and 10 at the Bucknell 14, they'll say. Sullivan out of the shotgun, rolls to his right, has his man Simons open in the corner of the end zone. They'll throw it up. He pushes off, and he catches it out of bounds. He pushed off on Robertson, no call. And then as he pirouetted after pushing off, it threw his timing off, and he grabbed it out of bounds. And then Robertson batted it out of his hands as well. Good job by Bryce, the freshman, as you can see on Bison Vision All Access from a reserve, Louisiana. And it'll be second down and 10 for Colgate, leading 24-21, 10 ticks left in the half.
I'm sure the weather has a lot to do with it, but Sullivan right now looks like he's throwing a hand grenade up there. He's just pulling the pin and letting it fly, and it just wobbles.
Got to be picked off for a touchdown.
You would think.
Yep. Here comes probably another throw with three wideouts right to Simons. Play action. Here is Selvin all day. Throws it over the middle. It's touchdown. Colgate.
And that was his best pass of the night.
And that's Rosnick who will grab it. And for Rosnick, for Colgate, that is going to be his first touchdown grab of the year. But Colgate's only going to lead 31-21 at the half, and that's good for the Bison. 3-0 Colgate when they lead at the half. Bucknell, meanwhile, will get the second half kickoff.
And that's what I was just going to say. Bucknell took and deferred the second half to the second half, so they'll get the ball, and the Bucknell offense has been clicking.
Big interception by the Colgate team as there was a man down in the end zone for Bucknell. And let's
see. Is that Robertson back there?
Could be Bryce, yes. It's going to be Bryce Robertson who was near that play, but nobody was really around Rosnick. They were paying so much attention to the receiver Simons that Rosnick was wide open for his first touchdown grab, and Bucknell would have to go very deep, as you can see a good picture of Bryce being helped off. He's pointing to his left shoulder. Here's Stein to try and make it 31-21 Colgate, but five ticks left, and Bucknell can prove it can score. Bison are going to have to do that a lot. Six-play, 68-yard drive for the Raiders here. And that pass to Rosnick from 14 out. Good job by the Colgate offensive line to give him time. Four of those five guys are going to be running out of eligibility at the end of this year. Stein waiting for the hold. Placement down, and the kick is up, and it is good. So 31-21, Colgate, five ticks left. Bucknell could still pull within 31-28 if Kizikai could get a kickoff return now. Do you think Coach Biddle will allow Stein to kick this one deep, or will he squib it?
No, as a matter of fact, I think he squibs it, and he aims right for the puddle.
That's right. There's a big puddle at the 35 on the deer hash mark as we look at it left to right.
I'm not picking on the field, by the way. I mean, this field is immaculate considering how much rain has fallen here throughout the day in the Susquehanna Valley. But that puddle that you're looking at on Bison Vision right now is exactly where you want that ball to land.
Let's see if Stein can do that. Stein, also a veteran for this team, senior. Tell you what, Coach Biddle has a lot of work ahead of him. He'll have Sullivan back, a great quarterback, but he'll lose four of his five offensive linemen. Bucknell returns virtually everybody next year. Meanwhile, Colgate will also lose Scott, who is not playing today. I don't know that he would have made that big of a difference considering, you know, Colgate scored without Scott, let alone if he was out there. So I don't know if he'd have made that big of a difference, but he'll graduate. Eaches is a great returning person there. They will have Simons back next year if Sullivan has time to be able to throw the ball.
But this offensive line has been the key tonight to this game for Colgate. They are opening up enormous holes in the middle of the field. You just can't believe that something like that can happen. They're not running on the edge. They're running in the middle of the field. Oh, you went for the puddle.
Oh, squib it. Kick, and Bucknell will just dive on the ball and run out this first half, possibly, with four ticks left. Massaro covered it up at the 29 of Bucknell. And, that, by the way, touchdown pass by the quarterback, Sullivan, his fifth of the year. We mentioned, of course, Rosnick with his first touchdown grab and his second pass reception of this particular game. So Colgate will lead. That's huge for them because their defense has been just as anemic as Bucknell's here in this contest. But the Bison still will get the kick to start this second half.
But, you know, the way the – I know they're going to kneel on it because that's the safe play. But, man, the way Bucknell's been able to move the ball and throw the ball against Colgate, you have to be half tempted to go for it, but they kneel on it instead.
And we'll have Tim Landis talk with Ryan Unger. Once Ryan finds him here, it's easy to find Ryan Unger. Let's go down to Ryan with Coach Tim Landis.
Thanks, Doug, with Coach Landis. Coach, good offense in the first half. Got to find a way to stop Colgate in the second.
Yeah, defensively, we're not getting it done, and we got to find a way to get it done. Credit to Colgate moving the football, but we can't give up a touchdown pass, you know, with 10 seconds to go. I mean, we're going to have to score points in the second half.
You talked about Hart going off the field here. Your team's got to dig deep in the second half.
Yeah, we are. We're going to be tested. We've been behind before this year. This is a real good football team, so we're going to see what we're made of here. No question about it.
Thanks, Coach. Best of luck.
Thank you.
All right. Thank you very much, Ryan Unger. as the Colgate Raiders will lead 31-21 as we go to the halftime locker room. Stay tuned. We'll have the Dunkin' Donuts halftime report coming your way next. That will include our Meat of Bison segment with Chris Wonkowitz, the senior offensive lineman, joining us. Then we'll get to hear from Bucknell Alumni Association Board of Directors Admissions Committee member. That's a mouthful there, Gary Thaniel, on our spotlight on Bucknell. We'll also have scores from other Patriot League games. That more comes your way on the Dunkin' Donuts halftime report. At the half, it's Colgate 31, Bucknell 21. This is Bucknell football on Eagle 107.
We're enshrined as the 30th class of the Bucknell Athletics Hall of Fame. And we would like to recognize these individuals at this time. Here with us to salute the newest Hall of Famers are Bucknell University President Brian Mitchell, Director of Athletics and Recreation John Hart, and Chairman of the Hall of Fame Committee and Head Baseball Coach Gene DePue. Our first Hall of Fame honoree is one of three Division I All-Americans in the history of Bison swimming and diving. He finished eighth in the 50-yard freestyle at the 1971 NCAA Championships, the highest national finish in program history. He won four straight conference titles in the 53 and two more in the 100 breaststroke, in addition to seven league titles in relays. During his senior year, he co-captained Bison to an 11-0 dual meet record, only undefeated season in team history. Ladies and gentlemen, from the class of 1974, Steve Winings. This new Hall of Fame inductee is one of the top women's distance runners in school history. She won the East Coast Conference cross-country title twice and finished in the top five all 4 years. And she won seven more ECC gold medals on the track. An all-East performer in both cross-country and track, she broke the Bucknell record in the 10,000-meter run by a whopping 58 seconds at the 1987 Penn Relays. No runner since then has come within 54 seconds of that mark, which is now the oldest running record in the Bucknell books. Ladies and gentlemen, from the class of 1990, Judy Perry West. Our next honoree is one of Bucknell's most decorated woman swimmers. She became the first female in Patriot League history to win the same event 4 years in a row when she achieved a four-peat in the 200-yard backstroke. A four-time All-Patriot Leaguer, she won three events and was named co-swimmer of the meet at the 1995 Patriot League Championships. Those are three of her 10 career Patriot League gold medals, which were a league record at the time. Ladies and gentlemen, from the class of 1998, Jen Myers Keating. This Hall of Famer could not be with us today because he is currently playing professional basketball in Russia. In fact, his amazing career with the powerful CSKA Moscow team led to his being granted Russian citizenship, and he led the national team into the Beijing Olympics this summer, making him Bucknell's fourth Olympian. Bucknell's career was not too shabby either. He was a two-time first-team All-Patriot League guard who ranked ninth in school history in scoring at the time of his graduation. And he is one of only three players in school history with 1,000 points and 300 assists. Ladies and gentlemen, another first ballot Hall of Famer from the class of 1998, J.R. Holden, represented today by his mother and father. Our next honoree also comes from the Bison swimming program. One of the top freestyle sprinters in program annals, he won eight individual Patriot League titles during his terrific four-year career. He won three league crowns in both the 50-yard freestyle and 100 butterfly, and he captured two gold medals in the 100 free. He was also a member of six Patriot League champion relay units. He was a two-time Patriot League co-swimmer of the meet, and he also won four ECAC championships. Ladies and gentlemen, from the class of 1993, Jay Gross. Our final Hall of Fame inductee was a standout on the field hockey pitch. She became only the second woman athlete to earn all-conference honors four straight years. A Patriot League all-decade team member, she was also a two-time regional All-American. She graduated with the school assist record and also ranked in the top five in both goals and points. Ladies and gentlemen, from the the class of 1994, Almira Baldwin Arnold. Let's have a big round of applause for the 2008 Hall of Fame class.
And welcome back once again to the Dunkin' Donuts Halftime Report. At halftime, you can see the score on our Bison Vision All-Access Colgate after an interception by Trigg, only his third thrown this year. And it was just a bad catch attempt by A.J. Kizikai. It wasn't Marcelo's fault at all, but good interception by Wayne Moten for the Raiders, and they take it in and take a 10-point lead into the break, 31-21. Here at the half, it's time for our spotlight on Bucknell, and I am so pleased to have this guy here. I'm going to have to look, unfortunately, at your title, Gary, because it's so long. He's on the Alumni Association Board of Directors, but he's on the admissions committee of that board of directors. His name is Gary Thaniel. Gary, great to have you on, man.
Thanks so much for having me on. I definitely appreciate it.
I tell you, you know, you graduated a few years ago here at Bucknell, 2004,
yes.
And you I tell you, there was nobody, I don't think, that I know of, any bigger a fan of Bucknell. Academics, athletics, whatever, always at the football, always at the basketball games, always at other sports. You love sports as well as the academics, don't you?
I love sports as well as the academics, and I love Bucknell. I mean, I think, you know, Bucknell is a great place because you have the opportunity to, given this small setting, you have the opportunity to really follow your passions. And I was very, obviously, you know, I was passionate about WVB radio, but I also was passionate about sports and just the competition. I also had a lot of my best friends were athletes here. So I think when you have, you know, when you have your best friends who are athletes here, you know, if I'm doing something, they're supporting me.
And
when they do, you know, when they're competing against other schools, I definitely have to support them. So for me, it was good, you know, to come out, support my friends, have fun, try to, you know, rally up some of the fellow students who may not know the, whether might not understand how big a game might be for the team. Just try to get them and, you know, communicate that to them. So, you know, coming out here, sitting in the rain, sitting in the snow to watch the team play football, or even, you know, driving buses down to see the Patriot League playoff or tournament when it was in Maryland. Those are the type of things I love doing. And, you know, I think, you know, you see the appreciation on your friends when they look up in the stands and they see you there, and you're like, you know, I am here to support you, man, you know. So it's a great, you know, I'm a competitive guy. I think most people here are pretty competitive. So you have to love the competition of sports. You know, these guys are sacrificing a lot to be out here to wear their Bucknell on their helmet or on their chest. So we need to, you know, encourage them and support them as much as we can.
Well, that brings up a good point because, you know, being so much, you had so many friends, whether it was basketball, football, or any of the other sports
right.
here at Bucknell, you know how much of a time commitment they had. But you were involved in so many different things. We mentioned WVBU, but it was a whole host of things that you were involved in. Your time commitment was pretty strained as well, wasn't it?
Yeah, it was very strained. And I think the one thing that I learned, besides the great leadership experience I gained here, being here at Bucknell, I think the one thing I learned, which is important, is time management. You know, I have a great network of mentors who are a few years older than me, and they were saying that you'll see as you get older that opportunities to be involved in different things never go away. And as you get older and you become, you know, you get a little more, you know, credentials under your belt and stuff like that, more and more people are pulling at you to do more things. So I looked at this as a growth opportunity. I mean, it's 4 years of your life, and I feel like this is a great transition phase. So if I can try to master time management or get time management down some way where my grades aren't suffering, but I'm not, you know, shortchanging any of my other commitments, which I was very passionate about as well, I thought it was a great opportunity to do both. And I think, you know, as we were saying earlier, it's a great place to do that. And, you know, I just thank everybody that had any, you know, anything to do with the WVBU or the success of the Fashion Club or, you know, all the residents, because they made it easy to do that stuff. You know, when you have a great team working with you, it's easy to, you know, take the lead and put the time in, because you see the finished product.
Well, how much, and you kind of touched on this, but how much does it help to be involved as a residence hall advisor or on WVBU or the Fashion Club or any of that? How much did it help you to be able to get to know a bigger network of people here? Even though this is a small campus, there's still 3,200 or so students.
Yeah.
You know, how much did that help you? You were as well known as anybody on campus.
It was essential. It was very important. I think, you know, even though Bucknell's a small campus, you can definitely get caught in, you know, get caught up in your little silo of your friends, whether it's your freshman hall, fraternity, sorority, maybe classmates, majors. You know, if you're an engineer, you may only hang out with engineers. I think that's the part of the, sort of the out of class learning model that we have here at Bucknell. You know, activities give you an opportunity to really meet people from different interests. And I've always been one of those people where I feel that the more people I meet, the more people I can build relationships with, the greater understanding of other perspectives on life I'll get. You know, whether it's someone who is an international student, you know, I can learn about what it's like growing up in Turkey, or whether it's someone who, you know, grew up in, you know, the middle of New York, and I can kind of get a better sense of what it's like to work and live in New York City, or even if it's someone who grew up in rural Pennsylvania, and I can get a sense of what core values they hold. I think all that really contributes to, you know, really contributes to you as a person. And I think the small campus feel of Bucknell encompass that, but I also think it's, you know, the activities that you're involved in really give you an opportunity to meet people on a whole nother level. I mean, we have some extremely talented students here. I mean, we have, you know, people who could potentially be artists, you know, musicians, fashion designers, you know, obviously businessmen, and hopefully, you know, politicians, world leaders, et cetera, engineers, as everyone knows. But I think the hidden talents is where you really find out what people are really into. You know, living with people as their RA, you learn what kind of drives them and what in a different way. Because I think in class, you know, everyone's sort of focused on, you know, if I'm a management major, I'm focused on my business. I'm a philosophy major, I'm focused on, you know, the elements of my philosophy major. But I think, you know, when you're in an RA, or when you're, you know, leading people in a club, I think you get to see another side of people that I don't know if people normally get to see just as classmates alone. So I think the extracurricular adds to the bonding. I think most of my best friends, all of my best friends I met through extracurricular activities and sort of that sort.
You may be able to watch on our Bison Vision All Access. Yeah. It's also the Hall of Fame induction ceremony that was held earlier today. The Hall of Fame members are being introduced right now, and those come from a whole gamut of sports: cross country, swimming and diving, also field hockey, basketball. J.R. Holden was one of those. And
it's crazy watching the Olympics this summer, seeing him on there. I was like, J.R. is on the Olympics, is on worldwide television, not even national, worldwide television, playing against Team USA. Which he didn't have, I think he had 19 or 17 against Team USA. That's not a bad game. I mean, he's playing against the best in the world. So, you know, he was definitely a key element of their team. But, you know, these guys, you know, like we were talking about the competition, these guys have sacrificed so much for Bucknell.
Indeed. Indeed. And, you know, you sacrificed a lot for Bucknell. As we mentioned, you're on the admissions committee and the alumni board. What does that entail?
I think the alumni board, our job is to really serve as sort of like, is to serve as a liaison between Bucknell's 50,000 alums and really the campus. In the university, we feel that, you know, in my opinion, Bucknell is a great 4 years of your life, but I feel like the Bucknell experience goes far beyond 4 years. College is 4 years and you can complete college, but experience and what Bucknell should mean to you should be a lifetime commitment. This place has given me so much more than I think I could ever give back to it, that I feel that being a part of Bucknell naturally makes me, you know, it's something that I naturally want to always be a part of. I love the people here. I love coming back here. This is a place like coming home, you know, homecoming. Every time I come back to Bucknell, it's like homecoming, because I'm coming home. I definitely feel that there's a community here that cares about me, that's seen me grow into from a boy to a man, and that's something you can't get anywhere else. So as with the alumni board, we want to do is continue to remind alums about that feeling, about you know, about the experiences they had when they were you know, students, and making sure that they harness those memories and don't forget that, you know, Bucknell's always home to them. You know, so often as young alums, we want to assert our independence and get away from Bucknell. But, you know, you can be independent and go on with your life, but don't forget about what's important to your life. You know, wherever I go in the world, I'm always going to make time to visit my mom and go home. Wherever I go in the world, I'm always going to make time to come back home and visit my friends at Bucknell and visit the administrators at Bucknell. And what the admissions committee specifically is doing to, you know, help foster that is really making sure that we're monitoring the activities of the admissions department here and making sure that the experience that we've had and we really cherish, every other Bucknell student that's coming through these gates has an opportunity to cherish. I mean, Bucknell is such a special place. You know, we used to joke around with each other when we were in New York, or people used to joke around with me when I was in New York that, you know, oh, you're part of the Bucknell clan. And we really are. We are close tight-knit group. You know, and I think the relationships you forge here, and I'm not saying that, you know, you can't do that, get that at any school, but I know you can't get it at every school. I'm sure, you know, there's some schools that people feel the same way, but I can only speak for Bucknell. And Bucknell, my friends from Bucknell are some of my best friends in the world. You know some of my friends, Dave, Milwaukee, Charles, Donald, all those guys. They'll be in my wedding. They'll be around when I raise my children. And we, in this place, you know, help foster that. And as the alumni committee, what we want to do is make sure that, you know, we're not only supporting the alums, but we're also supporting the students because they are young alums. Once you finish a semester here, you're an alum. And we want them to make sure, we want them to know, understand what it means to be a Bucknell alum, what the Alumni Association has to offer, because basically our network is so vast that it can benefit whether you're a sophomore in college or whether you've been in the work world 30 years. The Bucknell network is so well connected that it can benefit you in so many ways, and you can also help other people in so many ways through your connections. So I think it, you know, we've definitely seen increases in alumni activity with the school in recent years. So we just want to continue to build on that. That contributes so much to everything that we do, whether it's, you know, college ranking, whether it's, you know, endowment. That stuff really matters. And we got to make sure that people are, you know, coming back and invest in a place that invests so much in each of us.
Well, Gary, you've invested a lot back into Bucknell, and we appreciate so much you coming up and talking to us.
No problem.
So great seeing you, man.
You're such
a great friend of Bucknell University.
Oh, no problem. Thanks for having me, and good luck. And I'll make sure I see you at basketball season. I know it's coming up. And Ray Bucknell.
Indeed, Ray Bucknell. Gary Thaniel, class of 2004, just a delightful, great representative on the admissions committee of the Alumni Board of Directors. It's 31-21, Colgate on top of the homestanding Bison here at Homecoming 2008. We'll take a break, come back with first half stats in a moment. This is Bucknell Football on Eagle 107.
The second half with Bucknell receiving at the open end of the stadium.
And welcome back once again to Christy Mathewson Memorial Stadium, 31-21 Colgate, as we get ready to start the third period. Kevin Herr has our first half statistics. Kevin?
I do indeed. Bucknell with 9 first downs to Colgate's 16. Colgate has just been amazing on the ground. 32 carries, 208 yards on the ground. Most of those coming between the tackles, to be honest with you. Bucknell, 15 carries, 113 yards on the ground. Passing yards, the Bison throwing for 104 yards, and it is Marcelo Trigg that is only 5 of 13 with one interception. A lot of that having to do with the weather, a lot of that having to do with drop passes as well, but here was one of the most highest efficiency passers in the country, and he is definitely struggling tonight. For the for the Colgate Red Raiders, it is Craig Sullivan. It is 6-for-11 with one interception, 97 yards. He has thrown for a touchdown as well. I think the biggest statistic here in the ball game, as you look at things, you know, only 97 yards in the air for Colgate. They have just amassed, of that 305 yards offense, 208 of it on the ground, and they're averaging over 6 yards a play now just with that rushing attack. That is just amazing to me. Going to some of the individual numbers, Nate Eaches, who is in the game as a last-minute replacement for a pretty darn good running back as well, is having already a 100-yard game. He's averaging 5 yards a carry, 2 touchdowns. He has 20 carries, 103 yards, 2 touchdowns. Sullivan has carried the ball 7 times in the midline option, given up 39 yards on the ground. Jordan McCord, 3 carries, 39 yards and a touchdown. And Noah Jackson, 2 carries, 27 yards in the ball game. Receiving, Pat Simons, the guy who we thought was going to be the go-to guy, averaging 100 yards, 72 right now.
And Jacob Stein kicks this, and he will kick it out of bounds. Not a great way to kick that ball there for the seniors, so Bucknell will have it at it. At its own 40-yard line here, first and 10. So the Bison will have it at its own 40. That's kind of a tough break there for the kicker, Stein.
Yeah, he kicked the ball fairly well, but it just rolls right out of bounds. So Bucknell's going to have some pretty darn good field position. This is exactly the way they want to start the half, right on the 40-yard line, 60-yard short field. Now they have an opportunity to get back into this ball game.
Here comes a handoff, and Kizikai going to take it up the middle. And he fumbles the ball as he'll take it up the middle to the 45, up to the 49-yard line. And he covers it back up, and it'll be second down and 1. And a couple of fumbles here early. You may want to bring it back, Blair, if you're listening to us right now.
Second down and 1.
And we may want to tell the station to cut into our break now and just bring it right back, as it's second and 1. We lost our radio feed. We're still live on Bison Vision All Access, but a fortuitous bounce for Kizikai. Now here comes Lair, the quarterback. Reverse wishbone behind him. One wide out, Pasternak left side. Here comes the option, and Lair will keep it. Stutter past a man at midfield. He stripped, had the ball stripped, and it's picked up and run to the 42-yard line for Colgate as Lair lost the ball. And Colgate will come up with the turnover, and Vinny Nikosia will get the fumble strip away from Lair, whose forward progress was stopped. But the officials, of course, not blowing the whistle here today. And it's going to be first and 10, Colgate at the Bucknell 42. And it's going to be 38-21 Colgate here in a second, the way Bucknell's defense is played.
Well, that's exactly right. When you give up 300 yards in the first half and 200 of it on the ground, it does not take long for this Colgate team to score.
Nikosia comes up with that. He was a rookie of the week defensively earlier. First and 10, handoff to Eaches. He'll break it inside the Bison 40, and he'll carry would-be tacklers down to the 37-yard line. And it'll be a pickup of 5 on first and 10. Brigham Farron brings him down after that 5-yard pickup. 2 turnovers for Bucknell. 1, the interception led to points. And now this one, a fumble going to lead to points possibly at the 37-yard line. It'll be second and 10 for Eaches. Has 103 yards on 20 carries in the first half. As you can see in our Bison Vision All Access, second down and 5. Sullivan out of the shotgun, hands off to Eaches off the left side. He will get hit by Jones and get driven back. Of course, the whistle's still not blowing, so it looks like the officials are going to wait for about 20 minutes before whistles blew, even though Eaches was stopped on his forward progress. Probably should have gotten a fumble there. It's at the 34. It'll be 3rd and 2 now for Colgate, leading 31-21, start of the third period.
Some quick updates in the Patriot League. Holy Cross leading Lehigh 21-14 in the third. Lafayette having their way with Fordham 28-6 now in the third.
Here it's 31-21 Colgate in the third. 3rd and 2 for the Raiders. Sullivan, the shotgun quarterback, Eaches to his left. He'll get the handoff to Eaches, go the first down marker, And Kerry Dackler is inside the 32 to the 31 and a half. Being dragged down was Eaches by Farron and Manchuk. And it'll be a first and 10, the 17th of the game for Colgate, leading by 10 points. And Lair was stopped. His forward progress was stopped, but the whistle didn't blow, and that allowed Nicosia to come up with that big strip. And to be quite honest, Andrew Lair should have held the ball better. He holds it as if it's a loaf of bread a lot of times.
Well, once you're past that first line and you start seeing the defenders come up on you, you have to start carrying that ball, not to pitch it, but to run it.
First and 10, Colgate at the 32 of Bucknell. Back split for the shotgun quarterback. And here's the handoff. And McCord will get this carry, and he will actually be stood up, and the whistle blows a little sooner there. At the 33-yard line, he has stopped a whole host of bison coming in there, including Robertson, who had a stinger at the end of the first half. And let's go down to the field. Ryan Unger on the field here.
Thanks, Doug. You talked about him securing the football. That's what the offensive coordinator Harry Nichols said. He said, we're doing what we want to do, guys. We just got to hold on to the football.
You know, Bucknell had a turnover at the end of the first half, the third interception of the year for Trigg and only his 13th career. And then they fumbled to start the third quarter. Second down and 12, loss of two. Sullivan long count. Man jumped. That's De La Rosa. He's back, though. Eaches to his left. He'll get the handoff. And, oh, it'll be Sullivan keeping it for sizable yardage. Carrying tacklers inside the 30. Brigham Farron finally brings him down around the waist at the 26. But it's going to be a very manageable third and about four for Colgate, leading 31-21 with 11-21 left in the third.
You talked about fumbles. That's the first fumble that has actually been given away here in the ballgame, I believe. And on a day like today, when there's been a steady rain, sometimes a heavy steady rain, that's actually kind of impressive.
Now it'll be third and four for Colgate. Ball nestled inside the Bison 26 at the 25 and a half. Sullivan has been at the shotgun all day, and he'll do that here with Eaches off to his left. Two wideouts right. Eaches on the draw gets the first down and more inside the 23, and he'll take tacklers to the 21. And it'll be a first and 10 Colgate. Seventh play of this drive upcoming. The defensive stop made by Jones and also De La Rosa. And they'll spot it just inside the 22 at the 21 and a half. They're actually going to say they have to measure. I don't think it's going to be much. And even if it is, it'd be fourth and inches. So it wouldn't really matter for Colgate here leading by 10 points.
You know, you mentioned Jones in on that tackle. Jones actually got in the backfield early, had an opportunity to make that play for a loss, and somebody just put a stick on him right about the hip. How he got back in the play is beyond me, but that credit, a great job there of bouncing up after being on the turf.
They will stretch the chains out, and it is fourth down and just about an inch for Colgate. Bucknell got a fumble to start the third quarter on its offensive drive, and Bison trailed by 10 points, still trailed by 10, but fourth and an inch.
Now, again, they're going to come out in a shotgun formation. I'd like to see if the defense has been changed up a little bit here on this short yardage. Again, that's a big five-yard run. You have an opportunity to really read that play and stick somebody inside. Even though it's only about 3 or 4 inches to get this first down, that is a long run out of the shotgun.
Now Sullivan and company will break the Colgate huddle with the Raiders moving right to left here in this third period, leading by 10. Eaches to his left, Tupta now in kind of a power eye, although it's a shotgun quarterback Sullivan. Now the tight end will move off to the right side. That's Kvetic. And on fourth and an inch, hand off to Eaches. He'll have the first down and more going off right tackle and right guard. And he'll take it inside the 20 to the Bison 19, maybe the 18. De La Rosa brings the stop. And it looks like Will Braff is hurt for Bucknell here as he's laying down on his back. That'll give us a chance to say today's game is brought to you in part by M&T Bank. They understand what's important. With M&T Choice Equity, you can lock in a fixed-rate loan within your line of credit so your rate and loan payments stay the same. How's that for peace of mind? M&T Bank. Spot the ball at the Bucknell 19, pickup of two for Eaches. Be the ninth play of this drive, 18th first down of the game for this Colgate team. They now have 224 yards rushing, 97 passing. Bucknell has 232 total yards in this game and trails 31-21. And While there's an injured player out there, we can mention that Service First Federal Credit Union and Bucknell are teaming up for a special promotion. Stop by their Lewisburg branch and register to win a weekly gift certificate from Damon's Grill. You'll then be eligible for the grand prize, a chance to be on the air with the Bison Sports Network for an upcoming Bucknell home football game. Check out all the details at the Service First Lewisburg branch across from Damon's Grill.
I just got an update on some soccer. The Bucknell women's soccer team scoring twice in the first 20 minutes. And then a seven-save effort from Catherine Sutton, pitched a shutout, 2-0 over Lehigh earlier today.
And they are helping Will Braff off the field.
That doesn't look good.
No, he doesn't. Not putting much pressure on his left leg. So Bucknell will come in with Kyle Boline, as Boline will check into the lineup for him. The sophomore, 6'2", only 225 from Rochester, New York. At the 19, first and 10, Colgate leading 31-21, 10-17 left third period. Shotgun quarterback Sullivan into round. Here comes the handoff to Babb. He'll have a lot of room down the near sideline to the 15. Cuts back at the 12. And again, they don't make his forward progress stop with a whistle, and people pushing and shoving because of it. They were trying to rip at the ball, and Babb held on to it at the 12. That took a long time on the end of round. But what this is doing with such a slow whistle, it's starting to get people pushing and shoving, and soon there'll be punches thrown.
Well, that's exactly right. When you get a guy stacked up like that, do you teach your defender, strip the ball until you hear the whistle? And the officials are letting them try and get every extra yard they can. As a running back, you have mixed emotions about that. It's like, yeah, I'm okay with running that. I'm get a couple extra yards, but wait, when I see the ball fly out, please blow the whistle now.
Out of the shotgun, second and two at the Bucknell 11. Here's a hit on Eaches, but he'll fall forward, carrying Ronaldo inside the 10 down to the Bucknell 9, 8-yard line. It'll be first and goal for Colgate, leading 31-21, 9:20 left in the period here. And again, it's just basically taking guys for a ride. Bucknell just has 220-pound defensive linemen. That's not going to get it done in FCS football.
Well, Todd Ronaldo made the hit behind the line of scrimmage, but he was just drugged 3 yards down the field by Aegis.
He's listed at 251. He may be shy of that. First and goal, Colgate at the Bucknell 8 after the fumble by Lair. Here comes the shotgun snap. Hit behind the line was Eaches, and he'll be dragged down. Good job by Kyle Boline. He actually bounced into the pulling guard, left guard that time, for this Colgate team, Zach Posey, and knocked him in the backfield, and that allowed him to follow that guard and make the grab around the waist of Eaches from behind and drag him down for no gain. It will be the 12th play of this drive, second and goal at the Bucknell 8.
That play was busted up by the linebacker, Greg Jones. Greg Jones went right through the hole that was left when the guard was there, and the tackle forgot to down block him, and he just busted up the play.
Now at the 8-yard line, ball in the middle of the field. Sullivan gets the shotgun snap, goes option right, and he will drag tacklers inside the Bison 6 off right guard to the 5-yard line as he's dragged down by Akeel White, the free safety. It'll be third and goal for Colgate. 13th play of this drive. They've owned the ball from the 14:04 mark to the 8-minute mark and leading by 10. Even a field goal here would be big for the Raiders as it's third and goal at the Bucknell 4.5.
Kyle Boline that time lost his helmet early in that play, went in and still continued to play, and I think was actually in on that tackle. That's effort. I got to give him credit.
He came in for Braff, who is limping. Third and goal at the 4.5, inside handoff, no pass, right side man wide open, and it's touchdown to Tupta as the pass went off to the right side, and Tupta grabs it for his first touchdown of the year, his ninth grab of the year, and Colgate goes on top 38-21 with the extra point here. But Bucknell has a chance here, but they're going to have to stop minimize their mistakes.
Well, and somewhere along the line, the defense is going to have to stop. The defense is going to have to put up a stop. There's no question. Simmons that time on the outside read the option, stopped when he saw that the pass was coming up, and I'll finish that thought in a minute.
Here comes Stein. High snap, and the kick is up, and it is good for Stein, just barely. Great job by the holder that time, Myers, to put it down. And it's 38-21, Colgate, 7:39 left in the third. We'll take a timeout. This is Bucknell football on Eagle 107.
Announcement. You can tell us who Bucknell's next opponent is in
football will win a coupon for 50% off one item at the bookstore at Bucknell. Once again, the first person to report to the marketing table next to the concession stand after hearing this announcement to tell us Bucknell's next opponent is in football will win a coupon for 50% off one item at the bookstore at Bucknell.
Can you play station ID, Blair?
Jacob Stein, number 39, doing
before you send it back.
For Colgate back team for the Bison. Justin Pulgrano, number 24, and also number 22 is A.J. Kizikon.
Thirteen-play drive after the fumble. Here comes the kickoff to Bucknell's Kizikai. Breaks it to the near sideline to the 35, then gets stacked up and dropped at the Bucknell 36. 13-play, 42-yard drive after the fumble, and Todd Manjuck now comes limping off, and Bucknell has had a lot of guys injured, something you don't want to see Will Braff being treated now. Let's go down to get an update from our sideline reporter, Ryan Unger.
Yes, Doug. Trainer Mark Kepler continues to work on Will Braff's left leg. Looks like they're going to address it, put some more bandages on it. We might see him back here in the next defensive series.
Thank you very much, Ryan. Battling the elements out there. 7:28 left here in the third. Bucknell needs a big drive here. Not a very time-consuming one, hopefully. There's two wideouts split to the wide or left side. Bucknell moving left-right, two to the right. Shotgun quarterback Trigg has some time. Now floats one over the middle. Crossing pattern. Great grab by Kizikai. He drops the ball, and they call it an incomplete pass at the 39-yard line. So an incomplete pass, as grabbing him up high that time was the linebacker Hadley. The bad thing is Bucknell forced to pass here, and that's going to hurt because Colgate, which isn't a great defensive team, can just pin its ears back and run there. You get the feeling Colgate's not going to win the national title this year.
No. You know, if defense wins championships, it's going to be an uphill climb. But what I will say is that they've left Pasternak with man-to-man coverage on the wide side of the field, the far side of the field. They continue to do it. Look for a pump fake again. It's going to be there.
Here comes a play action. Trigg rolling to his left, throws it. It's tipped and caught at the 42-yard line. For a third down and five, it was tipped by Hadley, caught by Pasternak, alert grab over on the far side of the field by Sean, who has a touchdown grab here today on a 59-yard pass. It'll be a third down and five for Bucknell, trailing 38-21, 6:59 and counting third quarter.
See, that time he took Moten, the cornerback that was defending him, and Moten was actually getting about 10 yards, giving about 10 yards cushion, saw that, cut the pattern off, and gave his quarterback an opportunity to hit him for about 6-yard gain.
Third and five at the Bucknell 41, three wideouts. Kind of to the right side, fullback Mullen into block. Trigg throws it over the middle. Low grab by Bucknell for a first down at the 47. Again, Pasternak grabs it down at his shoelaces in front of the linebacker Hadley. First and 10, Bucknell. Let's go down to Ryan Unger.
After that last defensive possession, Coach Landis gathered his entire team around him and said, "We are not quitting right now. The offense not doing that so far."
No, the offense certainly has picked up a big first down there, the 10th of the game for the Bison. Trail 38-21, 6:33 left in the third. I don't think there's any quitting this Bucknell team. They may be outmanned by a veteran Colgate team, but not out-hustled or outworked.
No, absolutely not. Haven't seen it all year and definitely aren't seeing it here tonight.
Larian in the shotgun at quarterback. He'll fake the handoff going left to right, and then he'll come up the middle, and he'll take would-be tacklers inside the 45 of Colgate. Near a first down at the 43. Fake the end around to Marlon Woods, or maybe Josh Lee, going left to right, and then he just sprinted right up the middle of the field for another first down, or very close to it, at the Colgate 43.5.
Again, nice choice there. It looked like it was another one of the Lair's options, whether he's going to run the ball himself or whether he's going to hand it off. Found the hole up the middle. I thought it was a first down, but they didn't give him forward progress. Who would have guessed?
You see a lot today. Second and inches for Bucknell. Trigg back on at quarterback. Takes the shotgun snap. Goes with a play action. Under duress. Throws a wobbly pass. Left sideline. Another near grab by the Houdini-like Pasternak down on the far side of the field at the Colgate 30. But he was well guarded over there by Wayne Moten, a guy who picked off a pass late in the first half for Colgate. And he couldn't dig this one out, so it'll be third and an inch. Not a bad pass play, although you'd kind of like to go deep on third and an inch, or second and an inch.
Well, Pasternak that time tried to make a little hitch move in his pattern. He hitched to the right, cut it outside, and when he did, right there was Moten. He did not bite on the little hitch on the inside, so a nice job by Moten to stay where he needed to be.
Two wideouts right, Pasternak left on third and about half a foot. Inside handoff and getting the first down coming left to right is going to be Josh Lee. He is grabbed up high by Hadley, who has a number of tackles. We'll check that here in a second. Let's go down to Ryan Unger on a first and 10 upcoming for Bucknell at the Colgate 42.
Looks like Will Braff will be coming back into the football game. Trainer Mark Kepler came over and talked to him. I saw an affirmative nod from Will Braff. We'll see him in this next series.
There's a good shot of Ryan Unger on the sideline wearing the Barrow Tennessee poncho. The Vols play. My Vols play Alabama. They'll probably lose.
Nice wave, Ryan.
38-21 right now, Colgate. Out of the shotgun, first and 10, Trigg has a pocket, throws it on the right side to Odenbach, and Alex grabs it for a 3 or 4 yard gain to the 36-yard line. Colgate trying to keep everything in front of them, leading by 17, as that defensive stop made out there by Carbone for the Raiders. It'll be second and 4, and Coach Zabo, the new defensive coordinator for Colgate, starting to get his defense in line, only giving up 14 points, I believe, last week to Cornell.
Well, again, this is a Colgate team who has scored a lot of their points in the second half. They haven't given up as many in the second half. Matter of fact, they've only given up about 80.
Second and 4 play, pass near side, and there's a pass interference as Pasternak was run into, no flag, as the ball hung up on the near sideline. That allowed Epco to run through Pasternak. I guess the officials are going to say he was making a play on the ball. It'll be incomplete, so it'll be third and about 4 for Bucknell. Trailing 38-21, 4:27 left to play here in the third.
Actually, to be specific, Colgate outscoring their opponents in the second half, 112-79.
In the first half is when they've been outscored, and Bucknell didn't take advantage of that. Even though Colgate 3-0 when they trailed at the half, of course only 2-2 when they were leading. Third and 4. Shotgun quarterback Trigg backs to his left and right. Here's a blitz up the middle. Handoff will go to Kizikai, and he's hit at the 38 and drop. So it'll be a fourth down and 4 for Bucknell as the defensive stop made in there by Uziaida for Colgate. And now what will Bucknell do here, trailing 38-21 at the 38-yard line? It looks like Bucknell will go for it here, and it'll be fourth and about 6 for Bucknell.
That just looked like a missed assignment. There was nobody at all on the defender, and Ida came right in there and just put a pop on the back.
Middle of the field is open if Bucknell can give Trigg time, and you got to feel that Coach Zabo, the defensive coordinator, won't blitz here, but we'll see. Now Trigg under center on 4th and 8. Trigg, 4-step drop, throws it over the middle. There it is, and it's pass interference on Colgate. Should have been. Tip at the last second, and boy, just thinking he got by with murder is Ida. You could see his sheepish walk as he comes over the pass at the 22, intended for Pasternak, but I think that Ida may have gotten a little bit of pressure on him before, as you see a view of Pasternak, and Colgate will take over first and 10 at the Colgate 38-yard line.
Sean kind of discussed it with himself. He thought sure that he was going to make that catch. Pass just a whisker behind him.
3:41 left in the third, and Colgate will take over on downs for the first time here today at their own 38, leading 38-21. Sullivan, the quarterback, 2 wideouts right, probably be a heavy dose of Eaches. Here he goes with the handoff up the middle, runs over 2 or 3 men for a few yards to the 41. Bucknell has all 3 of its timeouts left as Eaches is grabbed by Boleen, and then also at the bottom of that pile, Brigham Farron, who's a little slow in getting up. Pickup of about 3. It'll be 2nd down and 6 or 7.
Boy, this has just been a very, very difficult game for the Bison. Very physical game. They've had a lot of players that have been on the training table. This is a game that Mark Kepler wishes he stayed home.
Get a good view of Brigham Farron, who's limping some out there. Of course, all these guys for Colgate on their offensive line, Jonas a senior, Snyder a senior, Rosabella a senior, Hennessy a senior. Colgate really, really focusing on this year to win the Patriot League. They have a big game against Holy Cross. Holy Cross was leading Lehigh last we checked. And then they, of course, have another big game against Lafayette. They haven't played those teams. In fact, they have one less game played because of the norovirus. Georgetown game was canceled. So if there's an undefeated situation there, it's going to go to losses as opposed to ties, and that could be tricky here. As it's 2nd down and about 6 for the Raiders at their own 42, moving right to left in the third, up by 17. Inside handoff to Eaches, comes up the right side and just will put his hand down and dive forward for near first down yardage. He actually got it, but they'll spot him a little short at the 46-and-a-half-yard line. It'll be a third down and one for Colgate.
Doug, if I remember right, Brigham Farron had a right knee injury earlier or something that caused him to wrap. I remember hearing about that earlier in the year, but I'm wondering if that's the same thing that they're looking at now. Or, I'm sorry, it might have been, I think it was a left, actually, not the right, but I wonder if that's what they're looking at now again.
Third and one, Sullivan out of the shotgun with Eaches off to his right. Two wide outs right at the 46. Inside handoff to Eaches. He'll have the first down near midfield. See, stopped at the Colgate 49-yard line. That'll be the Raiders' 19th of this game. They have now 251 rushing yards here in this contest. And the Raiders lead, 226 left in the third, 38-21, as you get a view on our Bison Vision All Access at the athletic training staff looking at the left ankle for Farron. Fourth play of this drive, Colgate stopping Bucknell on downs at the 38. First and 10, Raiders looking to win their fifth straight game. Sullivan has Simon split wide right, back split in the shotgun with him. Handoff inside to Jackson, and Jackson will be stood up and dropped. Well, again, they're letting the whistles blow, and there are a lot of late hits out there because that Bucknell's Bowling and also Travis Nisley, who is subbing for the injured Sam Nanasinkum, who had averaged about 15 tackles per game for Bucknell before the injury against Georgetown, hitting Jackson late because, or it could have been McCord late, but no matter what, hit him late because of the late whistles.
You know, you wonder if this crew may have had an issue earlier in the year with blowing the whistle a little too early, and maybe that's why they're waiting a little longer this time.
90 seconds left, third period. 17-point lead, Colgate at the 49 of the Raiders. Inside handoff to Eaches. He'll come up the middle for 7 or 8 or 9 yards. Take it inside the 45 of Bucknell to the 44. Tackle stop made in there by the Bison, as Akeel White helped to make the stop, but he's limping back to the free safety position too. It's a third and about three for Colgate at the Bucknell 44.
Again, right up the middle, the place where you wouldn't think that play would actually be successful, and Colgate has done it all afternoon and has done it successfully all afternoon.
Now at the Bucknell 44, it'll be a third and three for the Raiders. Sullivan, the shotgun quarterback, goes with a delay draw, a big hole for Eaches. He gets stood up and dropped down at the 38. Great job taking him on head-on-head that time and lifting him up with a form tackle. Casey Williams out of Moon Township, PA. First down for Colgate, but that's the way you need to tackle Eaches. Down low, twist his ankles, and do the best to bring him down.
Well, he lifted him clean off the turf and then ended up going right back down on his feet again.
First and 10, Raiders leading 38-21. The rain continues to pelt Christy Mathewson Memorial Stadium. Bucknell has two turnovers and an interception for Colgate.
This has now turned into a methodical drive by Colgate.
Already going on some 3.5 minutes at the Bucknell 38. Here comes the inside handoff to McCord. He gets stacked up, but drags tackler that time. Greg Jones, who lost his mouthpiece, to about the Bucknell 38-yard line, maybe the 36-yard line as he went off left side.
That's okay. He lost it in Lake Christie, so he can just go ahead and wash it off there.
There's a little bit. They were actually squeeging, as you get a good view on Bison Vision All Access. Little puddle here on the field turf surface. They were actually squeeging that at the halftime. Well, it'll be a second down and 9 when we return for the fourth quarter here for Colgate, leading this one 38-21. They'll have it at the Bucknell 36-yard line when we return with more. This is Bucknell football on Eagle 107. I guess we'll keep it right here. Start of the fourth quarter, 38-21, Colgate, as they'll move left to right here in rain-drenched Christy Mathewson Memorial Stadium. Raiders looking to win their fifth in a row would go 6-2 and 2-0 in the Patriot League. They will next play at home against Lafayette, at Lehigh, and at home against Holy Cross. Tough schedule for the Raiders. And then, even if they were to win the Patriot League, they would have a very tough matchup in the NCAA playoffs, no doubt, if they could get that far. Second and 9, the sophomore quarterback Sullivan out of the shotgun at the 36-yard line. Gets the snap, hands off to Eaches. Nope, he'll keep it around left side, and he'll pick up a first down and more. It's Casey Williams will drop him inside the 35. down the left sideline to the 34-yard line, faked it to Aegis, and then Sullivan kept it around left side for another first down. The 20th of the game for the Raiders. Ninth play of this drive, and they'll have it starting the fourth quarter at the Bucknell 24.
Casey put a hit on the quarterback that time. Unfortunately, it was about 13 yards downfield, but man, did he nail him.
We'll go to Ryan Unger after this play, which is the ninth play of the drive. Sullivan, out of the shotgun as he has been for the entirety of this game. Tupta caught a touchdown pass a moment ago off to the left. Here comes the inside handoff to Aegis. He will break free up the middle inside the 16 to the 15. He'll have a first down or close to it at the 14 of Colgate. And let's go down to the field and Ryan Unger.
It's a war of attrition in the Bucknell secondary. Zakeel White getting looked at too in his left quad right now.
Indeed he is, as we see Josh, one of the assistant trainers, looking at him. It's second and one for Colgate, leading 38-21. Start of the fourth quarter. Bucknell, for its part, will go on the road to Holy Cross next week and may have to do so with an even more depleted lineup than what they had coming in with Sam Nanasinkum lost for the year. At the 14-yard line, second and one. Aegis off to the left now, the quarterback, Sullivan. Takes the shotgun snap. Hands it off to Aegis. He'll get the first down as Kalaje ripping at the ball. Morgan will bring him down at about the 13, maybe the 12-yard line for Colgate, looking to put this one away. But, again, long road to hoe for the Raiders. And even if they were to win out the rest of the way, I don't think they're going to win the national championship or even go to the championship game like they did in 2003.
I'm not even positive that this is the team that's going to win the Patriot League. I mean, yeah, they can score when they need to score. Their offense is pretty prolific. I mean, you're looking at almost 300 yards rushing now early in the fourth quarter. But the defense is going to be the thing that is going to hold them back this year.
Bucknell has handed them a couple of turnovers here in the third quarter. Now here comes the quarterback using a lot of play clock down to two. That's Sullivan. Takes a shotgun snap. It's low. Goes with the fake. Now comes over the left side and he'll score. So he runs it off, faking it to Aegis right. He ran it off left, and he scores for his first touchdown via the rush here in today's game. And for Sullivan, it's his fifth touchdown rushing on the year. It's 45-21 Colgate. Most likely they'll make the extra point. Bucknell, a very young team, and they'll have everybody back next year. Colgate will lose a lot. They will have that guy back, Sullivan, and he'll have to work behind an offensive line that certainly Colgate has done a good job with over the course of the years, except for a couple of years ago where they really struggled and Bucknell won to go 6-5. Low snap, great job by Myers again to put it up and in. And it's 45-21 Colgate, 13-12 left in the ballgame. We're going to take a timeout, hopefully. We'll come back with more in a moment. This is Bucknell football on Eagle 107.
Score, Colgate 45, Bucknell 21.
Hey, Blair, how many spots do we have left in the second half? Okay, great.
The Bucknell Bison football team will be back home right here. Christy Matheson Memorial Stadium on Saturday, November the 8th. Kickoff is set for 1 p.m. Bucknell battles Patriot League rival Lafayette. That's the Bison taking on the Leopards of Lafayette College on the gridiron right here 2 weeks from today. If you want to watch the Bison online, it's game time. Bison Vision All Access is your online home for the most comprehensive coverage of Bucknell athletics. Fans, a reminder, this is National Collegiate Alcohol Awareness Week, and Bucknell University and the Department of Athletics are using this celebration to remind all Bison supporters to think and act responsibly when it comes to the use of alcohol.
After stopping Bucknell on downs, 11 plays, 62 yards for the Colgate Raiders, and they now lead 45-21. 13 minutes left in this one. Long kickoff, taken at the 4 by Kizikai, comes up the far side of the field to the 20, to the 25, and he'll race it all the way up to the 27-yard line. Good kickoff return for Kizikai, brought down by Rich Matz, and there's an injured player on the far side of the field. And it will be first and 10 Bucknell, trailing 45-21.
If Kizikai ducks outside about a half a yard to his right, Pelgrano has a block, and they have a wall set up that goes the entire way down to the midfield stripe, and he would have been gone. Gone.
Kizikai has done a good job breaking tackles. He probably felt he could break that tackle, and he almost did, but he'll be dragged down just shy of the 30, they'll say, at the 29-yard line. First and 10 Bison, trailing by its biggest deficit today, 45-21. And Trigg comes out at quarterback with Mullen and Josh Lee.
I'm still very surprised that it's man-to-man coverage here on Pasternak.
Pasternak hadn't had as big a second half as he did in the first. We had 90-plus yards. Here's a quick pass and a little mix-up in the receiving route. Kizikai came outside, and Pasternak went inside, and I think Pasternak was supposed to go outside, and Trigg throwing to the near side of the field threw it at the feet of both of them, incomplete. Second and 10.
Boy, and as a coach, and I'm sure Coach Nichols right now is shaking his head going, I don't understand how that happens.
No, because this hasn't happened all year long, and it's not the defense of Colgate that's doing that.
Well, here's another factor, though. There is a very stiff breeze that has developed in the last 3 minutes, literally blowing in the face of the Bison right now.
And that may have batted that pass down, although I think it was a wrong route run. Second and 10, out of the shotgun Trigg. He'll roll to his left. He's under duress. He'll be sacked inside the 20. Little jawing out there by Colgate. Could have been a flag on David Morgan, doing a little high-fiving and stuff. Morgan, let's see if he's a young guy. Morgan is a senior, not becoming of a senior. Drops him at the 20. Second down and 20. Make it third and 20, I believe, for Bucknell right now.
Well, you can see on Bison Vision now that flag is just stretched straight out. And actually, if I wouldn't be, there's a couple of people sitting under that flagpole. I might want to move the way that thing's wobbling today.
Here comes a third down and 20, really 19 at the 20-yard line. Now you can really hear the wind.
The bench moved.
Yes. Here is a blitz, all-out blitz, and Trigg takes time, goes deep, wobbly pass down the middle, and it's caught up in the air and incomplete. And, you know, of course, Colgate can tee off right now and come after Trigg when it's third and 20 and you're down 45-21. You know you're going to pass. But Pasternak almost came up with that. If that ball wouldn't have been adjusted by the wind, I think he would have, because the defensive back was playing well on his back that time, Moten.
It looked like you were hitting a driver into a stiff breeze at the country club, because that ball kind of wobbled in there and then just went straight down.
Good shot of an umbrella that has been destroyed.
It's the end of that umbrella.
Sideline. Here's Azrick on for a punt. Heavy pressure. He gets this one hanging up in the air as if an invisible hand got it. And, of course, Simons, who is not a good punt returner, just backs away from it, leading 45-21. No surprise there at the 43-yard line, first to 10, Colgate. You know, that's another thing that's going to plague Colgate if they were fortunate enough to win the Patriot League. You need special teams in the playoffs if you're going to win a national title. And Colgate just doesn't have any punt returners at all.
And you know what I don't understand is they have so much speed and depth at running back, but yet they don't put them back there. And maybe they're worried about getting them hurt. I don't know, but I found it strange to see how they're setting up returns here today.
At the 43-yard line, first and 10 Raiders leading this one 45-21 with 11:56 left. Sullivan, the quarterback, have a back off to his left. He'll get the handoff. Eachus, who had 241 yards last week against Cornell, take it off left guard behind Posey, left tackle Jonas. It'll pick up from the 43 of Colgate to the 47 for Bowling. Can help bring him down along with Cabrero De La Rosa, excuse me. And we're going to check some individual rushing totals for Eachus here in just 1 minute. Second down, Colgate at the 47 of the Raiders. 47.5.
I thought you going to break into John Facenda for a minute.
Here comes a quarterback keeping it, Sullivan. And I don't know if I'm him, I would do that, as he'll take it for about 3 or 4 yards down to the Bison 48. If Sullivan gets hurt, they did start the season with Ralph, but I'll tell you what, Sullivan is a much better overall quarterback. Not a great passing quarterback, but more of a threat to run than Alex Ralph ever will be. It's going to be third and one at the 48 of Bucknell for Colgate. And if he gets hurt, that would really hurt them, because you can run a running back all you want, but if you don't have another threat, and especially somebody to ease up the defense to throw the ball, that could be tough luck for Colgate.
Well, that's what I was thinking, too, and they might want to pull him out after this series simply because the defense isn't going to win games down the road.
Third and one, inside handoff to Eachus. He'll break it free into the secondary, to the 20, to the 10, to the 5, and a touchdown for Eachus, 48 yards. That will be his third touchdown of this game. He had three last week against Cornell. And Colgate on top, 52-21. If they get the extra point, 10:31 left.
They're going to be – that has to be like 500 yards offense.
That was 48 right there.
415 going into that play. So about 450.
And here comes Stein, whose leg's going to be a little tired at the end of this one. 10:31 left, 51-21. Raiders, soon to be 52-21. The extra point. And it's up and it is good.
The kick
is good.
And it's now 52-21 Raiders, 10:31 left here in this second half. We're going to take a timeout. This is Bucknell football on Eagle 107.
Ladies and gentlemen, come join head coach Tim Landis and members of the Bison football team for its weekly fan luncheon every Tuesday at 11:30 a.m. at the Lewisburg Hotel. Admission is only $8 and includes a buffet lunch. Fans, mark your calendar Thursday, November the 6th for the annual men's basketball tip-off reception at the Town Tavern on Market Street in Lewisburg. Jacob Stein doing the place kicking.
Jordan Scott scored or rushed for 270 yards against Bucknell's D last year. And Colgate came from behind to beat the Bison. 214 yards for each of us. Here comes a kickoff to Kizikai. Comes in a circuitous route. Breaks it free to the near side, to the 35, to the 40. Stein getting juked to jive, and Stein will grab him out of bounds along with a teammate past midfield at the 46. That teammate was Will Griffin. I don't think Jacob Stein's going to be tackling A.J. Kizikai too many times on kickoffs. A.J. had a kickoff return for a touchdown last year in Hamilton, and he almost broke that one. Stein rushed him to the sideline and then got whoop, 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 juked and jive. But first to 10 Bison at the Colgate 46, trailing 52-21, 10-17 left. Three-play, 57-yard drive by Colgate. 48-yard run by Nate Eaches, his third touchdown run of the year. Here's Trigg out of the shotgun, low snap, sets up the screen, and that's to Pasternak on the left side, and he will grab it for a yard down the near sideline to the 46-yard line before being grabbed from up top by the Raiders' Mike Carbone.
Ryan, I'm curious. It looks like the rain has stopped. Which is worse, the constant rain or the wind that has now replaced the rain?
Poison, Kevin.
What was that?
Pick your poison.
It's not good, no doubt. It was no gain, they'll say, to Pasternak on the little quick screen to the near side. Second and 10, orange and blue trailing 52-21. Just about 9.5 minutes left in this one. Trigg, the quarterback. In the shotgun, Kizikai off to his right, Lee to his left, play action to Kizikai, blitz is on, and Trigg will be sacked. Helmet to helmet hit, could have easily been called that time on Nikosha, who came up with a fumble recovery. Trigg didn't even see him, and they will give him forward progress somehow to the 43. It'll be third down, and basically Bucknell has to get to Montoursville.
Well, that was an all-out safety blitz. I mean, they just said, okay, unleash him.
Which you can do exactly when you're up 52-21,
exactly,
and you know you have to pass.
That's exactly right.
Now Trigg a little woozy on that helmet-to-helmet hit. Officials aren't making that call this year. We've seen that a lot here this season.
It's a call they're making more in the NFL than they are in the NCAA. As a matter of fact, there are a lot of fines in the NFL this year on helmet-to-helmet hits that were never called. So a new emphasis may be trickling down.
Third and 20, safety blitz. He goes high head over heels, long pass to Pasternak, and he'll grab it to the original line of scrimmage on the near side of the field, the 46. Then he dropped down, be fourth and 10, Bucknell. Epco brought down Pasternak. We'll have to check his numbers here and see how many grabs he has today, as it will actually be just a yard short of the first down, or the original line of scrimmage, excuse me, at the 47 of Colgate.
Pasternak with his seventh reception for about 105 yards.
And Pasternak already had three 100-yard-plus receiving games. Actually, Simons has not caught a pass, I don't believe, in the second half. If so, maybe a screen pass. He had 97 yards rushing at the end of the half. A timeout taken by Bucknell with four on the play clock, fourth and 11. Bucknell will go four with 8 minutes left at the Colgate 47. Down 52-21, you get a shot in our Bison Vision All Access. So the Bucknell huddle, and Harold Nichols, the offensive coordinator here. Bucknell is really, give credit to Colgate, but not a whole lot. I mean, in the sense that, not downplaying Colgate's defense, they've done a good job. Bucknell has handed the ball to him once off a pass late in the first half that Kizikai had bounced off his chest, basically. He didn't have his hands out. He tried to catch it off his chest, and it bounced right into the hands of Moten, who then Colgate, offensively against Bucknell's Ole defense, able to score and take the 10-point lead at the half. And then Lair running really had his forward progress stop, but the official didn't blow the whistle. And that's what they've done against everybody here today. They've let him go for an extra 3 or 4 years before blowing the whistle. And Lair, by that time, of course, after about 25 minutes of standing and dancing, he had the ball stripped and stolen, and Colgate scored there to go up 17. And then Colgate can just pick on Trigg and company passing so they can send the whole kitchen sink.
Colgate's really done a nice job in this rough weather condition of not turning the ball over. I mean, Bucknell's turned it over twice. They're minus three on the year. Colgate coming in plus two. They're now plus four.
Now all-out blitz on 4th and 11. Trigg hits hit as he throw a wobbly pass down the middle. It's going to be caught! Oh, it's caught! Pasternak inside the 10. He leaped up, and guess what? He says, hey, Nikosha, take that one, baby! Inside the 10 at the 9, and also guarding him was Moten. It'll be first and goal at the 8 for Bucknell. What a great grab by Pasternak.
I have seen him make one of those in the last 3 weeks, and I still can't figure out how he absolutely does that. I mean, here's a guy that is not 6'5 by any means, outleaping guys that are bigger than him making that play. I mean, he's 6'3, and that might be a slightly favorable 6'3, but man, what effort he has.
On a 4th and 11, 39-yard grab. Now Larian at quarterback, reverse wishbone behind him. He'll go with the fake. Hand it off. Nope, he'll take it around right side. And he'll take it inside the Colgate 5, down to the 3, to the 2. And then brought down at about the Colgate 2 by Nikosha again, who had gotten that fumble in the early part of the third quarter after Bucknell got the opening kick of the third quarter. Spot the ball just inside the Colgate 3, sixth play of this drive, and Bucknell will have it second and goal.
Yeah, Lair came off limping that time, so Trigg comes back in. But, you know, I talked about having to get Lair to throw the ball once or twice so teams can't key on the run, but he is so good at running that midline option and making the right read that they can get away with it.
Eye formation, in fact, a stack eye. Three backs behind Trigg on second and goal at the 3. Here comes Trigg running the option right side. He'll dive to the goal line, and is he in? It's very close. Nobody stopped, just inches short by, I think, as the defense of Colgate says they had a loose ball there. Barley, I think Barley made the stop. It'll be third and goal just outside the Colgate goal line. Seventh play of this drive for Bucknell, trailing 52-21.
Pasternak corner of the end zone.
Maybe a pass. As Lair comes back in, maybe
well,
not.
Well, maybe not now.
We'll see. Is Trigg?
I like the man-to-man coverage. I like the way he goes up after the ball. I think he gives you the opportunity.
I think Marcello wanted to
watch Lair off the line, too.
Third and goal. Lair just punches it up behind his left guard, Dalbello, and
they're marking him short. Wow.
It's going to be.
I don't know how he cannot get in the end zone with that kind of surge.
Yeah, touchdown!
Okay, that's better.
Your Bucknell Bison. The officials this year have been horrendous at waiting to make a call. Maybe that's the best thing. You got to be sure there. But Lair was about halfway in the end zone. Trigg earlier in the Duquesne game, I think, was about three quarters of the way in the end zone. And the official waited and waited and waited. But finally, Lair goes across for his fourth rushing TD of his senior year. And it'll be an extra point by Drew Orth. Bucknell trailing 52-20. 8 if they make the extra point, 6-8 left.
I couldn't quite figure out what was taking so long. Lair was in the end zone, did his touchdown dance, went on the sideline, took a drink.
Lair to hold here. His brother Alex, the snapper, and it's a high snap, but Andrew Lair puts it down, and the boot is through by Drew Orth. And it's 52-28, and that's a big drive for Bucknell. Then Bucknell may not get the ball back here in the next 6:08 of this ball game, but it shows what Bucknell can do against this Colgate defense, which, again, isn't one of the best in the league. The best in the league, bar none, is Lafayette's.
Well, and, you know, Pasternak has just stepped it up again. You know, they needed a clutch play. They're throwing the ball into what has turned into a very stiff breeze. I would say in the range of 20 mile an hour from time to time to the opened end of the field. The rain is now coming back to make it even worse. And Pasternak just went up against all those odds, outleapt two defenders to get that ball. And that's the kind of play that Bucknell gets from him that really, I think, lights a fire under this offense and under this team.
Colgate has scored 5 straight times, the last of which was 5 ticks left in the first half. This is the first score for Bucknell since 7:21 of the second quarter. But Bucknell, I think, could have scored two or three more touchdowns if they just wouldn't have shot themselves in the foot with an interception late in the first half and a fumble, which, again, whether I think Lair should have, his forward progress should have been blown dead, but it wasn't. And again, the officials doing that all game long, not blowing the whistle until 30 minutes after the play. But Lair getting that fumble and Colgate, you know, obviously taking advantage of those plays and scoring. Bucknell took advantage of the kickoff return by to Kizikai here, only having to go 46 yards and doing it in seven plays to score their 28th point.
You know, that had the setup for a minute there of a jailbreak onside because Colgate had their front four, mind you. They're in a semi-onside kick formation. They had their front four way over to the far side of the field, but it looks like they're going to line up and now creep up a little bit more.
Drew Orth checking off to his right and to his left. Will Carney was injured. He was the normal kickoff guy, and it'll be a high kick. That's a free ball that's loose, and it hops right into Jackson's mitts, and he's going to catch it in the puddle and then race off to his left to the 35-yard line. Will be first and 10. Raiders leading 52-28.
Yeah, kick at the puddle.
That's right.
Kick at the Lake Christie.
And Bucknell did that, but it was a fortuitous hop. We've seen a lot of fortuitous hops for Bucknell and Colgate here in today's game.
Well, you talk about the interception that bounces off of Kizikai's shoulder pads right into the hands of the defender. There was a fumble earlier by the quarterback Sullivan that bounces off the turf and right into his. That's a home field bounce that you're not supposed to get when you're on the road.
And we do have a new quarterback now, as it'll be the freshman Steve Ruzzo, and he'll get a low shotgun snap, hand it off to the right side, and here comes Jordan McCourt. Good job by Coach Biddle, leading 52-28, putting in some subs. Tackle made on the near side of the field by Greg Jones, who has hit very hard out there, along with Josh Gornto getting an opportunity. Good view of him out of North Carolina, Durham, North Carolina, the home of the Duke Blue Devils. Pickup of two from McCourt. So Rizzo, the Audubon, New Jersey freshman, three-time first-team all-conference, comes in now for the Raiders here, and that's a smart move. You don't want to get Sullivan hurt because I don't think Rizzo is going to win a Patriot League title for you.
No, and you want to get this kid some experience, too, as a freshman. I mean, let's be honest, there's your quarterback of the future, and if he doesn't run this offense very well as a freshman, he's got opportunity to make it better.
Hand off. Jackson breaks free down the left side. Has it past midfield. He'll take it inside the 45, down to the 43-yard line. Tackle stop made by Bucknell's Kyle Boleyn. First down for the Raiders, their 22nd of this game. And let's go down to Ryan Unger. Ryan?
Yeah, Doug, Coach Landis talking to the officials, asking for the holding call, but also saying the wide receivers of Colgate are cut blocking down on the defensive backs. He said we've lost two defensive backs. You got to keep your eyes open.
Well, that's a good point. Bucknell, of course, in the spread option, known as a cut-blocking team, but not necessarily downfield as much as at the line of scrimmage where it is legal. But when you cut-block downfield, that is not legal, obviously.
And Ryan was right. There was a hold.
First and 10.
It was a big one.
Rizzo gets another low snap out of the shotgun, hands it off, and this is McCourt getting stacked up behind left guard Jones, and also John Von Paris brings him down. John Von Paris, great story. They brought a bus from Maryland, he and his family did, and had about 50 people here for today's game. They always pick one game a year to follow their youngster, the sophomore out of Maryland, and they picked this one. Not a great one to pick, obviously, because of the weather. Pickup of a couple for McCourt. It'll be second down and 8 for Colgate, leading 52-28, 4:15 left in this ball game. Ball at the Bucknell 41.
That's a great family name, too, Von Paris.
That's right.
That's a really strong name.
Sounds distinguished, doesn't
it? It does.
Rizzo coming in this series for Sullivan. We'll give you his numbers here in a minute. Second and 8, low snap again. He'll creep down and get it, hand off, and coming up the middle is going to be Jackson. Good hard running for the youngster. He'll take it inside the 35 to the Bucknell 33. Be upended there, just about a yard short of the first down at the 33-yard line.
Boy, you know, even with a lot of second-teamers in, and I think you're seeing second-teamers on both sides of the ball, too, right now, Colgate's offense still showing why they're averaging 6 yards a game and why they're able to move the ball so well in the second half.
Third and 1 for the Raiders. 3:20 left in this ball game, leading 52-28. Shotgun snap up coming to Rizzo. Good one this time. He'll hand it up the middle. And McCord will spin for a first down down to the Bison 32-yard line. Again, some late pushing and shoving out there, and there's going to be a flag on Henry, who grabbed Bryce Robertson up high, but I'll tell you why it's happening. It's because the whistles have been late, and these guys have been pushing and shoving after the whistle is blown, which it didn't blow for about 5 minutes, and it's going to be on a, instead of a first and 10, it will probably be a first down, but it'll be first and about 15 for the Raiders here because a post ball, a dead ball foul there on Ty Henry, who shoved Bryce Robertson after the play. And it's not necessarily the player's fault because they're hearing late whistles and they're going to the whistle blows and it never blows.
I think I figured it out. I just noticed that because of Breast Cancer Awareness Month, the officials are using pink whistles. They're not used to those whistles, so they're working a little bit differently than the normal whistles they're used to using.
Well, there's Greg Cabrera. Good shot of him as he called the post foul on Henry.
I didn't realize that till now.
That's a good call.
That explains it.
I think that's the first penalty we've seen on Colgate here today. We'll double-check that. The Bison, I believe, have been called for only one. Very well-played game in terms of penalties. Move the ball back to the Colgate 47. Colgate leading this one 52-28, under 3 minutes left, and now be first and 10 for Colgate at the Bucknell 47.
Bucknell's lucky. Usually that's called on the reaction and not the perpetrator.
No, the freshman Bryce Robertson did a great job holding back. Another low snap to Rizzo. He'll hand it off, and up the middle comes the running back as Michael Tong, first time he has seen some action that I can recall since that game against Duquesne. Pickup of three that time on the running back Jackson. It'll be second and 7 for Colgate, just trying to run out this clock here with 2:27 left. The book on Eaches, he completed all but 5 of his passes. Well, he completed another one, but it was an interception, and he completed it for 101 yards, touchdown to Tupta, and then also he rushed for 79 yards, and Sullivan also rushed in one touchdown as well.
Quick upset in the Big Ten. Indiana defeats number 22 Northwestern 21-19. Northwestern 6-2 going in.
Big win for Indiana. Here's the inside handoff to McCord. He'll break a tackle, carry it on second down and 6 for first down off left tackle inside the 40 to the 36-yard line.
Actually, I want to correct myself. They were 6-1 going in. Now they're 6-2.
That's right.
Well, that was leading up to an interesting scenario with Northwestern not playing Penn State. If Penn State were to work their way through, there was a potential tie with two teams that didn't actually play each other.
See, that's what the Big Ten is losing out on, a championship game. Just like the Big 12 and the SEC, Pac-10's losing out on it too. But, of course, they're saying we're not because they'll go to the Rose Bowl and they would have that weird thing that the team that had not been to the Rose Bowl in the longest would have gone. Bobbled snap out of the shotgun. Rizzo will hand off, coming to the near side. Going to be a penalty flag down. Ball is stripped off the running back running to the near side, McKenzie. I think McKenzie recovered at the Bucknell 30, but there may be two or three holds. And a lot of the Bucknell fans thought there should have been holds earlier in this game that weren't called. Maybe that's why Colgate's offense is so good. They get by with a lot of holds, along with their huge two offensive tackles that are in line for NFL status. Each is for his part, rushed for 214 yards in this contest. He had played for a little bit. Net yards now 490 for Colgate.
Wow.
And they'll call the hold on Colgate, which will move it back to the Bucknell 46. 121 left, 52-28 Colgate, looking to win its fifth in a row. And this play will be brought back on a first and 20.
You were talking about the Big Ten not having a playoff as the Big 12 and SEC, for example, does, but their argument is, well, we don't want to penalize one of our teams for a shot at a national championship by having to play a very competitive game right before bowl season.
And that has hurt, in some cases, the Big 12, not necessarily the SEC as much. Dancing his way as Jackson, running hard, staying on his feet inside to 45 to the 42, running off. Well, it was behind his center, but then he bounced out to the right side. Of course, those offensive linemen, the veterans, have been replaced on this series. A lot of young guys out there for Colgate and for Bucknell.
And they're big, too.
Yes, they are. Whew. Just not as experienced, and that means a lot for an offensive lineman. At the 41-yard line, it will be second and 15 for Colgate.
Wow.
Last play of this drive, by the way, I see Tyler Anderson out there for Bucknell's defense.
Sorry, Doug, I was looking at Merrifield that just popped out. He's a 6'3", 266-pound freshman offensive lineman. He's still growing.
Inside handoff to McCord. on 2nd and 15. He'll take it off left guard inside the Bison 40 to the 36-yard line. Be interesting to see if Colgate can run as well as they are against Lafayette's defense when they play the Leopards later. But that will end this ball game, and Bucknell unfortunately couldn't go out to a 2-0 start in Patriot League play for the first time since 2003. Bucknell is going to win or lose its first game after winning against Georgetown last week, and the Bison are going to fall to 4-3 and 1-1 in Patriot League competition as Dick Biddle and Tim Landis shaking hands there at midfield. The Colgate Raiders going to win their fifth in a row. They will go to 6-2, and the Raiders are going to win, have a winning season for all but one of those years for Dick Biddle, and Coach Biddle was not a happy guy, nor is Coach Landis, as you see him right now walking off the field on our Bison Vision All Access. Coach Biddle was not a happy guy a couple years ago when they suffered a losing season. Even if they would have beaten Bucknell in 2006, they'd have had a losing season. They finished 4-7, but it was those big offensive linemen that are seniors now who were youngsters then, and you got to wonder what's going to happen for Colgate next year when they have a lot of youth on the offensive line.
Well, Colgate's big problem this year is the defense. Now, the defense played a little bit better, but then again, when you look at it statistically, Bucknell was playing from behind, so as you said, a couple of times in the second half, it gave the opportunity to call a safety blitz and figure if we get beat, no big deal. But I'll tell you, the defense for Colgate has got to step it up here in the second half of this season, or they're going to be hurting against some of the really, really strong ones, as you mentioned, like Lafayette's offense.
And the final score on your score, your television or monitor, I guess, right there. It's our television, but it's probably a computer monitor for you folks watching on Bison Vision All Access. Colgate does win its fifth in a row. And the Raiders will do it without Jordan Scott. I don't think, again, that he would have mattered a whole lot in this game because Colgate's offense worked very well without him. Bucknell, of course, did miss Sam Nanasinkum. But, again, I don't think that Sam would have made that big of a difference. I just think Colgate was much better than Bucknell as they celebrate here. The final score, the Raiders 52 and Bucknell 28. Stay tuned. We're going to have our McDonald's postgame show coming your way in just mere minutes as we will present an interview with Coach Tim Landis. We'll also have final game statistics, and we'll also have a look at other Patriot League scores. Again, the final score here this afternoon, it was Colgate 52 and Bucknell 28. This is Bucknell Football on Eagle 107.